Hey, everybody. Welcome back to another episode of 11. What the fuck? That's not our show. I almost said 11 o'clock comics. It's like wrong podcast. Okay, here we go. All right, one more time. And one, two, three. Hey everybody, welcome back to another episode of Comics Rot Your Brain, the show where screenwriters talk about the comic books that we love mostly from the 1980s. I'm one of your hosts, I'm Steven Bagatourian.
And I'm your other host, Chris Derrick.
And Chris, speak of the devil. We are here today to talk about The Blue Devil, a comic book from DC Comics published in 1984. Technically, it was just Blue Devil, I believe. And it is one of the most fun comic books ever in the history of mainstream comics. I love this comic so much. And let me just tell everyone what it's about. Blue Devil is about a fella who's a stuntman slash special effects prop guy in the movie business. And he winds up getting stuck inside of a prop costume he has built for an 8-foot tall blue devil creature, an actual blue demon. And his body ends up becoming grafted and melded with the actual costume when he is cursed by an actual demon who the movie crew accidentally summons while shooting a movie on location that is about a demon. And the whole thing is very meta and crazy. And the first issue is all about our character, Dan Cassaday, fighting off this demon back to where he comes from and then realizing suddenly, oh my God, I'm stuck in this devil suit. It's a wacky adventure series, the kind we don't see too much these days, where it is just so much fun. And we're going to be reviewing the first 5 issues of Blue Devil here today. And man, it is a jam-packed 5 issues. And it's wildly written by the writing team of Dan Mishkin and Gary Cohn. Beautifully drawn by the art team of Paris Cullins and Pablo Marcos at first. And then soon to become the art team of Paris Cullins and Gary Martin moving forward after the first couple of issues. And the whole thing is quite the spectacle. But man, I love the heck out of this series. I'm glad we're covering it today, Chris. Blue Devil is the ultimate wild fun escapade in comics form. This comic helped me fall in love with comics, and I'm eternally grateful to the existence of Blue Devil. So yeah, this is a fun one.
This is a great read for anyone who hasn't read it. You got to go pick it up. I know they changed the character when they brought him back, like the New 52 or something like that, and people aren't too excited about the current version of the character. But go back and read his original issues. You'll see something that's sort of unique, sort of too fun for its own time. It's too fun for now as well. And let's talk about what's happening in pop culture at the time.
Oh, but before we do that, we want to tell you about our new and improved Patreon, where members can participate in our exclusive monthly Q&A episode. And there'll be a few other surprises that will only be announced there. You can find out more details at patreon.com/comicsrotyourbrain. There'll be a link in the description box. And now let's turn back the clock to 1984.
So a few things I found out that I thought fascinating was this year in 1984, the Oscars, right? The film that was sweeping the awards was Terms of Endearment, because like, you know, because Jack Nicholson got Best Supporting Actor, Shirley MacLaine got Best Actress, and it got Best Director, and it also got Best Picture. So, which is crazy. You know, for a movie like that, which I don't think people even talk about or remember now, you know, just pretty much swept the awards. You know, a few other things of note was that that Linda Hunt, she got the Best Supporting Actress for A Year of Living Dangerously, and Bergman's Fanny Alexander, which I think was his final film that he released as a theatrical film, that got the Best Foreign Film. Let's see what else. Stephen King was actually killing the New York Times that year for bestsellers. He at the start of the year, he had Pet Sematary, and that was a huge hit. It was consecutive for about, I don't know, 5 or 6 weeks in a row, and like several different times. And at the end of the year, he had it again with the Talesman that he wrote with Peter Straub, and that I think was the last 6 or 7 weeks of the year as a bestseller. In comics, 1984 was the year of Marvel's Secret Wars, and every month Secret Wars was the number one selling comic per the per Capitals thing. Like they said, the second issue sold 250,000 copies. Now, wow. The one thing that people don't have, because there's no real data on January's sales numbers, was January was the year that Spider-Man 252 came out, which was the introduction of the black costume, which later became Venom, who's actually one of my least favorite characters of all time. you know, and then also, interestingly, is in DC's situation, they were trying to do something new with a book like Blue Devil, which we're going to talk about now. And it's kind of crazy because in issue 5, in the meanwhile column, you know their VP editor, Dick Giordano,
yes,
he talks about like what they were trying to do. And here's a quote from the page. It says, "We know we could milk the success of Teen Titans and Legion of Superheroes by cloning or spinning off new titles from those titles. The advantages are obvious. The advantages are also short term. We know we could borrow the success of properties developed by others by licensing profitable in the short term, maybe. But we know we can generate a good chunk of revenue by reprising everything good and everything not so good in our library. Again, short term. Instead, we chose to build for the future with diverse formats, genres, and styles like Camelot 3000, Nathaniel Dusk, Frank Miller's Ronin, Thriller, which we talked about on this podcast by Von Eden and Robert Lauren Fleming, The Omega Men, Blue Devil, and Vigilante, which even though they fall broadly into the favored genre of superheroes, they try to appeal to different segments of the audience by using a different approach, to that favorite genre. So this it's kind of fascinating because that's what corporations would not do today. They are, yes, all about brand extension. Let's just milk something to it's dry. Fuck the new. Fuck the different. Is like, I mean, it's sort of what is going on in the world at the moment. Oh, and the last thing I want to say about what's going on in the world is this is the year that Ronald Reagan ran for re-election, and he beat the living tar out of former Vice President Walter Mondale. That was one of the biggest landslide victories in American history.
Wow.
So now let's talk about this book, Blue Devil, which I got to tell you, man, just like reading it now, it's a very fun book. And I kind of forgot that comics could be fun like this, because books today that are not – can you think of a book today that's fun like this?
No, I don't know that I can offhand. I mean, I think that's definitely something I realized looking back at this too, Chris, is this does feel so different than comics today in so many ways. I mean, like, there are books out there that are, I know, supposed to be like the fun comics. Like, I know there's, you know, but they seem like they're often aimed at kids more squarely. Like, I don't read that one book. What is it? Like a Moon Girl and Devil Dinosaur. Marvel does that book. It's kind of a fun book. There's a cartoon connected to it. I would imagine that's kind of like in a somewhat similar fun vibe, but it's more youth directed and like kind of kid oriented, as far as I can tell. Blue Devil was like a mainstream DC comic that was, you know, about aimed at the general audience of all DC comics. It wasn't squarely a kid's book, but it just is so much fun, pound for pound. It really is a different type of comic book experience. And it's interesting that DC was really aiming at that target squarely. And I think it's Mike Gold, our old friend Mike Gold, the editor from the Thriller comic that we covered so extensively from Von Eden and Fleming, and Alan Gold, the editor. Did I say Mike Gold?
Yes, you did.
But oh, yeah, my bad. Yeah, Alan Gold is what I meant to say. Mike Gold's a different editor, but Alan Gold was the editor on Blue Devil as well as Thriller, and he was the arch nemesis of Fleming and Von Eden, but he he appears to have had a somewhat more copacetic relationship with Mishkin, Cohn, and Cullins, at least based on the first few issues and his generally sunny tenor that he has in the letter column, where he seems pleased as punch with this book. And, you know, for good reason, it is a really fun book. But he talks about how, I think it was Len Wein who spoke with Mishkin and Cohn early on. And it was Len who the guys actually credited for really pushing them in the direction of fun, fun, fun. This needs to be a super fun character. This comic does not need to be like dark and serious or whatever. Len Wein saw the potential for like this character to be like just a wacky swashbuckling character with a fun cast of characters. And I don't know how Len Wein necessarily saw that vision, but I think he was right on, because I think the spirit and the vibe of Blue Devil is, like you say, not at all something that's in vogue in comics now. And I think it was one of the reasons I fell in love with Blue Devil and with comic books altogether so hard was, I think Blue Devil number 10 was one of the very first comic books I ever bought. And I remember buying it at a Circle K with my dad, where I bought all my early comics, little liquor store. And it was the comic that I was immediately obsessed with, and it was relatively new, so I could go and trace back the earlier issues. I was like, oh, there's only 9 issues that exist other than this one? Wow. It wasn't like Superman, you know, 379 or Batman 426. Like, it felt so attainable as a kid. Like, wow, I'm almost in on the ground floor of Blue Devil. And I just love the character, man. It totally spoke to me. I had so much fun with it. I feel like I read my Blue Devil floppies over and over as a kid. And I guess looking at it now, and just, it's funny that you and I are, you know, we work as screenwriters in Hollywood. And I mean, this comic was probably my first exposure to the idea of like behind the scenes in Hollywood and filmmakers and scripts and directors and all that. And reading that now as an adult who's worked in the business, that was also an extra kind of like fun little thing to notice about this book, that it is like a behind the scenes Hollywood comic in a way. And yeah, the whole thing is like, it's a really unique stew. And I think something that we probably should throw out there, just broadly speaking, is, you know, what is the pitch for Blue Devil? What's it about? I mean, I'll see if I can sum it up in a log line, and please tell me if I'm missing something or what I leave out. But it's about a stuntman slash sort of stunt, like he's like a stuntman slash kind of special effects whiz kid, like kind of a engineering genius slash stuntman named Dan Cassidy, who puts together a bizarre like devil costume, a giant 7 foot tall devil costume that's blue with giant horns that an actor, and I guess in this case he as a stuntman, is intended to wear in this sort of like schlocky adventure movie that's being shot on an island somewhere. And the movie's called The Blue Devil. And in the midst of shooting the movie, one of the actors, the actresses, she accidentally summons an actual devil, an actual demon. And the movie crew ends up almost getting killed, except the stuntman in the crazy devil costume ends up saving the day and somehow fighting off this scary demon character. And in the process, by the end of the first issue, he realizes the demon has cursed him in some way and stuck him in the devil suit. And now the stuntman is stuck in the suit that he created, literally looking like a giant 7 foot tall blue demon. And that's the setup for Blue Devil, who is going to become a very weird type of superhero.
Yeah, I mean, look, that's it. I guess the one thing I would say is it's not that he's necessarily stuck in the suit. He's like, he becomes grafted to the suit. So
yes,
the suit,
that's
is
right,
him.
Thank you.
You know, in a way, like it's a like you said, like the devil, the demon is his name.
What is his name? Nibiru, or like he's got a weird demon name.
Yeah, it's like that. It's like Nibirios or whatever it is. But he puts that spell on him, and the suit is him. So he
yes.
like his nerve endings like connect to it. It's kind of an interesting story because it puts him in that like total reluctant hero situation where he's yes. not even expecting to do any of this, and he's only trying to fight the demon off because he's in love with the girl who's the actress of the piece. And it's kind of an interesting story. It's a look, I think what you said about it being a fun thing that we say a lot in the TV writers room is it's a romp. yes. whole time. You know, it's a yep. romp because they're having fun, but then they, you know, the whole time, and they get involved in, at least the guy, his name is Dan Cassidy, the Blue Devil. He gets involved in these battles for life and death, but he's sort of got to laugh at it the whole time because he takes his plight seriously, but he doesn't take the fights seriously.
No.
And it's not that he doesn't take him seriously. What he does, something I noticed, and I doubt I would have noticed this as a kid, but I noticed it now, is he basically is Spider-Man in terms of his – like he gives quips and stuff like that when he's fighting. He's got this – the suit that he made has got these servos in it. So he was going to be stronger. Like he's like 20 times stronger and all this kind of stuff like this. And so when it's grafted to him, he's like that too. He's got agility and strength and you know, and there's a scene where he gets shot later on by Metallo, and his chest is burned, and you see the circuits, but then it all heals up. I thought that was a really cool like moment. I think that was in issue 3 or something like that.
Yes, it was.
But that's just getting ahead of ourselves. But yeah, there's the Marvel the Marvel about making it fun. Like Spider-Man was always a fun book, you know, when he was fighting. And there's a really fun line somewhere where Metallo says, where he references Marvel in the dialogue, because it's all, it's, did you see that part?
I think I remember him saying something about a Marvel of a something, or yes, like, he says the word.
Yeah, and it's like a quip he's giving. I'm like, oh, that is it. He's Spider-Man, and he's jumping around and flipping the way Spider-Man does. It's a very kind of, it's a smart thing for them to decide what to ape from Marvel. Because at this time, we know that everyone is trying to ape from each other constantly, and what that is. I think this is a good series for them to create, to say what makes Spider-Man fun, like what makes the spectacular Spider-Man comic a little different than Amazing Spider-Man comic. It's a funner book in a certain way, you know. And I feel, and what's the other one? Was it the web? There's the web of Spider-Man, Spider-Man and Amazing Spider-Man. And I feel like that the web was a little more serious, spectacular was more of a romp. And
Amazing was like the flagship.
It was the flagship, and it felt like a big melodrama with, like, you know, and when the big stuff happened and everything. Like, I mean, that's how I remember. I could be wrong, and everyone could smack me, but that's what I feel. I mean, fucking Charles Vest did the cover for Web of Spider-Man, so you know it's like. It's more cerebral. But I feel the Blue Devil was like, how do we channel that kind of energy, and, you know,
the fun, wisecracking, Spidey? I think you're totally right. The Spider-Man thought, I think, is spot on. That is exactly like the archetype. You know, he's constantly quipping throughout every fight, you know, like even when he's fighting the demon in issue number 1, where, I mean, frankly, logically, Blue Devil, Dan Cassidy, he should be terrified. Like, it's a very scary giant demon in front of him, and the demon is coming after him, and the demon's even calling him little brother because he thinks that Dan is a demon also because of the way he looks. And the demon says, hey, you are quick, little brother, but Nibiru's raking claws are faster. And Dan Cassidy, aka Blue Devil, says, oh, you're just mad because mom always liked me best.
Yeah.
And, you know, he's like playing into the demon's joke about them being brothers. And like, this is, it's completely not realistic, quote unquote, but I don't care at all because it is just fun. And that's really what the target was for Blue Devil. And I think they hit the target square on. And Alan Gold talks about it in his text piece, I think, at the end of issue number 2, where he says that's really what they were going for in this book. And he makes a point of delineating and differentiating what Blue Devil is intended to be, as opposed to books that are more what he says are like pretentious or quote artsy schmartsy. And he talks about how this is not that kind of book, and Blue Devil is great because it doesn't kind of fall into those tropes of taking itself too seriously. And we know, and people who listen to our extensive deep dive on Thriller, the comic that had come out just the previous year, before Blue Devil, that Alan Gold used that exact same phrase, artsy schmartsy, as a way of being demeaning and derogatory toward his own creative team on Thriller after he fired the writer and was about to chase off the brilliant Trevor Von Eden. Alan Gold called that book artsy schmartsy in its letter column as a way of dissing it. And here he is favorably comparing Blue Devil to these, you know, to these other books, quote unquote, that he doesn't like. And I think now we can kind of track the progression of Alan Gold's thoughts on what type of comics he likes.
Yeah, I think what I find shocking about, but it's very good kind of like, you know, historical, the archaeology of what this guy's his career path was, and he likes this type of stuff, and those type of comics that he does. I think it makes sense now as to why he rejected Alan Moore to come and to be who volunteered to be the writer on Thriller, because, yeah, you know, and at the time, like, because looking in this book in the floppies, you see like there's ads for the Swamp Thing that he's writing. It's like he's seeing Swamp Thing, and that's probably a book that he thinks is too arty, and he's like, oh no, I don't want no shit like this. But it's crazy because it's like, why did he even like approve Thriller if that's not the type of, you know what I'm saying? Like,
I think he wasn't the one who approved it. I think it was Dick Giordano and perhaps Jeanette Kahn who had to approve Thriller. Alan Gold was a young editor, so my understanding is he was just assigned to Thriller as like one of his very first books. And I guess, you know, in defense of Alan Gold slightly, I guess the only thing you can say is that he was early in his career. He was a young editor, and so he really didn't know what he was doing. But yeah, I believe it was an assignment for him, and I doubt very much that he would have approved Thriller based on his reaction to it.
I mean, you know, there's nothing wrong with Blue Devil. Like, we're not trying to shit talk the book at all.
No, not at all. I love Blue Devil.
It's just one of those things where it's kind of like, oh, this guy, here's the thing that it shows you about how difficult it is to work in the creative space, is that the person who is who's the point person at the company,
mm-hmm,
doesn't like the material that he's been assigned to work on.
Right.
And therefore he's sabotaging it subconsciously,
yes,
from the get-go.
Yes.
And it's funny because I've heard people tell me in Hollywood that when you're a new executive at like a studio or something, like particularly at the studios and the networks, is that the way they haze you as an executive is they give you the sci-fi projects.
Whoa, shit. I've never heard that. See, that's insane.
It's because most executives don't like science fiction.
True. You know,
they don't. And so therefore, the people that they are like, oh my God, oh, guess what? So you're new here, or you know, you're not proven that you're loyal yet. So do the sci-fi project.
Oh my God, that's so crazy. It's punishment. It's hazing.
It's punishment. It's like you got. You,
oh my
you know
God.
What? Hey, there's couple sci-fi projects we're developing. Those are now yours.
Wow.
And I think it's why that, you know, and I guarantee you, most of these executives don't come into the business to work in the science fiction. I mean, there's some that do, but most of them want to be like, you know, they basically want to be like high end like book editors, right?
In terms right.
of like the same type of like, hey, I'm not a writer, but I want to be involved in the creative space, and therefore there's the big money, and I get to be smooth around and blah blah blah. And the stuff that draws people to work is usually a drama they love or a comedy that they love, not like, you know, some big sci-fi piece. And therefore, like when they get it, they're like, "Oh my fucking God!" Because most of the time, sci-fi stuff, it's hard to like kind of like it's hard to get close to it emotionally, because the writers are more interested in like what the big idea is than what the human emotion is.
Yeah,
and
I think that's true, right? With most sci-fi, that's often the rap against sci-fi is like, yeah, "Oh, it's cerebral, it's emotionally cold," and you know, I would argue that great sci-fi, of course, does not have to be that way and is not that way. But, you know, and sci-fi can also get into spaces where it's dealing with ideas and, you know, stuff that maybe might not be as simple and could, God forbid, come across as artsy schmartsy to someone who thinks like, you know, hey, comics should just be fun, kids. That's it. Nothing more, nothing less. But I think what Alan Gold didn't realize and what maybe some of the creators like, you know, the aforementioned Von Eden and Fleming were more attuned to is that comics were about to go through a dramatic change here. And this is 84, right? So this is right, you know, on the cusp of all these new books that are coming out and that are about to change comics forever. And you've got your Dark Knights and your Watchmen's and your Ronin's right around the corner. And even, you know, thank goodness the upper levels at DC, they were not all thinking the same about this, as we see from that Dick Giordano Meanwhile editorial that you're reading from in Blue Devil number 5, where Dick himself says, we're not going to be doing the same old, we're doing Nathaniel Dusk, we're doing Ronin, we're doing Camelot 3000, and they're pushing into all these areas. So it seems like, thank God that Alan Gold's point of view on what comics should be was not the sole point of view being represented by the higher ups at DC, because if it was, we never would have got all those great books. But, you know, thank goodness that he was consigned to the books that were under his purview. And I think what bothers me the most about it, Chris, is that, you know, having worked in creative spaces like you and I, mostly in Hollywood, we've experienced that ourselves quite a bit, where you're working on a project that you know creatively has got something special about it and is maybe really original or just has like an amazing, you know, quality to it in some way. And you know, it's something that's going to be super dope that people are going to love, or the story is just working. And then an executive will kill it or put the kibosh on it because it just is something that they happen to not like in general, based upon their whims. And based upon their whims, which are not based in anything like at all other than their own personal peccadillos and their own preferences or whatever. And genuinely, who cares about that? Like, literally, who cares about someone's personal preference, whether, you know, someone likes fun comics or they like more serious comics? That shouldn't be your job as an editor, as an executive, to tell the creative people exactly what they need to do, like based on your, what you happen to like. That's just silly, you know? It's totally silly.
It's silly. And you also sabotaging the work because you subconsciously don't want to do it. And I feel like everyone, you know, wants to do something that they're passionate about. And if they're trying to do something that they're not passionate about, you know, it's this line that my dad used to say to me all the time. He used to say, you're either helping me or you're hurting me.
Yes. You know? Yeah. That's a great point. Cause that's what an editor or an exec does, right? Cause you create a space that's either supportive or non-supportive. And if it's non-supportive, then it is effectively, it's hostile, because how is a creative person supposed to do the work if they know that their executive is going to be fighting them every step of the way?
Yeah. Yeah. It's sad that that's the place. But okay, but real quick, so I know we found the original proposal for Blue Devil.
Yes, we have.
Yeah, so we should read like maybe like the first page, and just so people can kind of get a sense of what this is from how it was pitched, you know.
I think that's a really cool thing.
So real quick, everyone. So right now the book, when it comes out, is created by Gary Cohn and Dan Mishkin. And an artist named, or the writers, the artist's name is Paris Cullin. But what's fascinating is that when they pitched it, they wanted Steve Ditko to write this.
To draw it.
Which I think is fascinating again, because it goes back to my idea about it being like Spider-Man. And they were like, oh, let's get the Spider-Man artist to do our book, because we're kind of channeling that same energy.
Yeah, 100%. And I think, Gary Cohn and Dan Mishkin were coming off of writing Amethyst, Princess of Gem World, right before this, which they had also co-wrote for DC, which was another very unique original creation for DC Comics that had just come out. And Paris Cullins was an up-and-coming artist who was one of the only young black artists at DC Comics at that time. And that's interesting, similar to Trevor Von Eden at that time. DC had a handful of black artists that were working on a variety of books there. And Paris, I believe, was quite young at the time that he got this assignment. And he was being inked by Gary Martin, who is, I think, a fairly experienced inker who would go on to ink Steve Rude at times on Nexus and other parties. So, you know, it's a pretty solid team. And also, not for nothing, I don't know if you noticed, the colorist on Blue Devil is our old friend Tom Zucco, who colored Thriller as well. Yes. So you got a certain amount of the Thriller team here with Zucco and Alan Gold and Todd Klein, the legendary Todd Klein, lettered this book. And I don't remember if he lettered Thriller or not, but Todd Klein is, of course, an all-star letterer, one of the greatest letterers of all time. So yeah, you got some really interesting people on this book. And that pitch document that we were talking about, we found that online. We happened to see the original pitch document. We thought it would be worth revisiting and maybe just taking a look at that pitch document briefly here.
And some will do is the pitch document, there'll be a link to it in the show notes.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I think that's a really good idea. Chris, do you have the pitch doc in front of you? I had it a second ago. I'm just pulling it up again.
I do. So here's the first paragraph. It says, Dan Cassidy and Dave Kaufman are a team of young independent filmmakers, Hollywood whiz kids. Cassidy is a stuntman / special effects wizard, while his lifelong friend Kaufman is producer, director, a master of getting the best out of the least. Both still in their mid-20s, they have developed a reputation for remarkable fantasy film work at cut-rate prices. Now the pair is on location for their first completely independent production, a project shrouded in secrecy entitled The Blue Devil. The plot of the film involves an archaeological expedition exploring the ruins of an ancient temple found on an island in the midst of the Bermuda Triangle. The island and the temple are real, the eerie location rumored to be the locus of bizarre supernatural phenomena. The ruins have, of course, been thoroughly examined by genuine archaeologists, and the government of the small island group of which this is one of is part of has seen the promotional benefits of allowing the island to be used as a film project. The central action of the film involves an attack on the members of the expedition by a demon, the Blue Devil, a malevolent being left over from prehistoric contact with the nether realms by builders of the edifice.
So that's just so interesting in the actual pitch document, because it is quite meta, because what they're sort of describing here as the plot of the movie is that this demon is disturbed and attacks the members of this expedition, ends up basically being what happens to the film crew. They disturb an ancient demon who attacks them in the middle of making a movie about an ancient demon being disturbed and attacking some interlopers. So it's all kind of inception-y worlds within worlds here in Blue Devil. Very meta.
Yeah, very meta. I think the difference in terms of like reading the pitch doc, obviously there's two proposals you find online, but this is the initial pitch doc. It says it's Dave Cassidy and Dave Kaufman. And in the comic, it's not Dave Kaufman. It's the woman named Marla Bloom.
That's right. That was one of the big changes. They replaced the character of Dave Kaufman in this original pitch with Marla Bloom. And I think it was a really smart thing. And so Marla Bloom has now become the one who's the director / producer of the film. Yeah. And she's in charge, and she's this tough woman and I actually thought that was really smart, because it's also a unique character, because as we know in Hollywood, you know, always, but especially then, you know, it's rare, unfortunately, to see a woman director. And so having a woman director directing a big action movie spectacle like The Blue Devil was actually a pretty uncommon, unusual thing, especially in the 80s. How many women action movie directors were making films in Hollywood? Right. None. Basically none. Like Catherine Bigelow would come along maybe a bit later with, what was it? After Dark, the vampire movie.
Near Dark.
Thank you. So that's a really interesting choice to go with Marlo Bloom here. And I think that actually improves things. And it's interesting looking at the front page of this Blue Devil proposal, because it literally says for Steve Ditko, series proposal, The Blue Devil. So this literally was written and given to Mr. Steve Ditko. And as we know from previous episodes where we talked about Ditko, like in our question episode, Steve Ditko famously follows the teachings of Ayn Rand. He believes in objectivism. He only wants to work on comics. He did only want to work on comics that lined up with his moral philosophies of objectivism. And I'm quite sure that Blue Devil just did not fit the bill, did not meet the requirements for Mr. Ditko, which is why I imagine he passed on this. I believe he did. And actually, thank goodness he did, because I think that Paris Cullins is the perfect penciler for this. And I think that Cullins and Martin, they get better and better as the series goes on. It's a little bit rough in places, I would say, at the beginning, but it does, from the outset, have the right bouncy feel that you need for this comic. A super fun, super bouncy feel. And as it goes, I think the art gets more and more like sophisticated in its way, but it's a really fun style. And Paris Cullins would go on to also have a very lengthy run on the Blue Beetle comic, which was written by Len Wein after he finished his run here on Blue Devil. Paris Cullins may have thought he was only going to work on characters who had the prefix blue before their name at some point. I don't know what the third character would have been, but Paris Cullins had a really interesting career because he was a very significant artist at DC Comics for a good decade there. He was one of the artists who relaunched Jack Kirby's New Gods at one point. And he drew a pretty lengthy run, like 15 issues or 20 issues on a New Gods relaunch at some point after Blue Beetle. And people don't talk about Paris Cullins enough these days, but he was a very significant artist at DC Comics. And he was a favorite of mine as a kid. I really loved his work. I thought it had a terrific energy to it. Really, really fun stuff.
Well, I think what's interesting, just to point out, everyone, the first issue is actually inked by a guy named Pablo Marcos, and Gary Martin comes on, I think, in issue 2 or 3.
Oh, but, thank you.
But see, here's the thing, this, like you said, it's that I think that he's figuring out how to draw the character in his first issue. But what I do like about it is that all his panel designs and the page designs and the compositions are very well done in terms of like trying to figure out how to tell the story. There's a couple of pages that have like some weird kind of layouts, some really weird layouts.
Yes.
You know, but the creature design is cool for the Blue Devil and for the demon, you know.
Nibiru's. Yeah, Nibiru's looks legit. He looks scary.
Right, right. So this thing about this guy, the demon, Nibiru's, like, his design is really dope. It's so otherworldly. It's interesting that it's not even like its own. Like, I can't tell what he's referencing. You know, like, it's not like Fin Fang Foom or anything from like Cthulhu or anything like that. Like, he's Paris Cullins. He's come up with his own kind of creature design, which is pretty cool. And I have to respect him for that. In a whole bunch of ways. I mean, if you think about it, I think it's on page 16, the first panel, really, really dope, the silhouette of the creature, which I think is pretty cool for just like how he's shown art.
Yeah, that silhouette where he's going, ha 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 ha, Nibiru shall feast tonight.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah, it's really good. That's a really dope panel. We're going to definitely feature that in our video with the full moon behind him. I want a t-shirt of that. That's fucking great.
Pretty dope.
Yeah. And he's holding, I just realized he's holding, what's her name, in his hands. He's planning on feasting on, what's her name, the girl that that Dan's got a crush on.
Sharon.
He's like Sharon, yes.
Yeah. It's, you know, and he's just like sprinting off with this girl. I mean, so the rest of the issue is Blue Devil, he's fighting the bureaus, right? That's like the whole issue.
Yeah, right. Yeah, that's totally it. And let me just jump in real quick on the Nibiru's design inspiration. I think Paris Cullins took some inspiration from actual insects. That's all I can think, because I you're right. It's a very original looking demon design, but I feel like Nibiru's looks like Paris Cullins, like, picked up some sort of actual books on insect anatomy and decided to just go crazy with like the thorax and like some sort of like insectoid breakdown of like the parts of some kind of extreme close up of a bug and just made the bug look really demonic. But I love it. But that's the only reference I can think of, is he demonized some insect. But yeah, it's phenomenal design.
That's true too. But the one thing I look at now is if you look at where's the splits is on page 21, right? The middle two panels, he almost looks like he's stone. You know, like his tail looks like it might be stone.
Or something.
I mean, he did a really smart job.
Yeah.
I like the way that he designed the temple and I can't remember what this is supposed to be, but they explain later on that like he's from like some real prehistory type of stuff.
Yeah. Oh, there's that awesome book that Zatanna from the Justice League shows up with later, and it's like the demon Bible, the demon history book, and it's got the origin of Nibiros. And yeah, like he's been around since like the times of Atlantis and shit. Yeah, there's like he's an ancient demon. So, and I gotta say the design does look quite timeless. Like there's nothing about Nibiros that screams 1983 or whatever to me, or 84, whenever we said this is. Very timeless.
Now I'm sure if this creature showed up today in a comic and it was colored with the way they color books now, it would still look scary. It would still look, insane. There's another great panel on page 22, the far right panel where the blue devil is riding him. Like look in the Bureau's eyes. It's like all those little like it's all bloodshot to a certain degree. He's got all this kind of like Easter. He's doing a lot, man. He's doing a lot.
So, oh, yeah, you're right. Yeah, I love his eyes. Yeah, no, Nibiros is awesome. I'd like a Nibiros miniseries one day. Very underutilized demon character, as far as I know. So issue one, basically, what happens? It's really like Nibiros, more or less, they kind of sort of banish him. They do banish him back into his dimension, just barely. They trick him back into the dimension from whence he has escaped. And now Dan's left with the rest of his film crew on the island. Dan's freaking out. And the very end of the issue is when he actually realizes, oh shit, I can't get out of this suit. I'm stuck. Oh my God. Wow. That hurts. It's like yanking on my own. No. That mystical blast did something to me. Mystical blast from Nibiros. I can't get this devil suit off. And that's like his final scream to the heavens at the end of issue number one. And, that's a pretty great cliffhanger for the end of Blue Devil's first issue.
Well, I think what's kind of cool, though, just real fast, what we give away is that they hint at what's going on the previous page. There's that middle panel where he's like talking with Sharon. And there's that middle panel on the bottom row where he's sweating.
Oh, yeah. He looks like hell. You're right. He looks like he's going to pass out.
Yeah. And it's kind of like, wait a minute. How are you sweating through the suit? So it's a very interesting kind of like setup, So that's issue one. Issue two is, it's now the series rolling proper. And he's fighting this character named Shockwave, who is I guess he's a minion of... What's the guy's name? The Superman villain?
Metallo.
Yeah, Metallo. And so, so he's gone in and he's stolen some synthetic kryptonite from Star Labs. And he's on the, it's a pretty easy job for him because his suit, he's sort of like the mutant, what's the mutant for the X-Men? Richter.
Which one?
He's sort of like
Richter. Oh.
When he stomps his leg, He sends like an earthquake shockwave like through the ground, which is kind of a weird power that's through a suit,
I mean, it kind of seems goofy, but now that I think of it, I guess in real life that would be pretty terrifying if somebody could do that. I mean, it seems silly because his costume does look a little goofy and he seems a little goofy, but yeah, okay, that would be scary if someone could actually do that.
So, but I'll go back to my thing about how I admit that this is like the Blue Devil is like here's DC trying to do Spider-Man, right? And so I feel like Shockwave is like a combination of the Shocker and the Rhino, right?
Oh, interesting. I like your Spider-Man sort of theory here. Yeah, I can see it.
Because here's the thing that I think that I also was kind of fascinating, and I never thought about this until I was older. But as a kid, I used to think about there's all these villains who get stuck in these weird suits, who get experimented on. They're like these dumb thugs who are given a certain kind of power to extend their ability to be bullies. And I feel like that's the whole deal with Shockwave. Because he goes in, and he steals. I mean, there's like no security like at Star Labs. You know, he just goes in, he just steals this shit. You know, I mean, and it's for the first four or five pages. You know, but he kind of he just reminds me of the guy who plays the Rhino. I don't remember that character.
No, I could see that. No, he's totally a Rhino archetype. He's like a big, kind of burly, thug. Who is pretty rough and tumble, and he's rude to everyone, and there is security barely at Star Labs, but as you kind of imply, it's pretty incompetent, kind of pathetic security, and they're no match for our friend Shockwave.
Well, it's funny because it's kind of like they're just security guards.
Yeah,
and I hate to shit on our. What's our editor's name? Alan Gold. I have to shit on him.
Oh no, we can't. We can't say anything else negative about Alan Gold. I feel like our show we're getting to be too much. I don't want us to feel like we're picking on him too much. But please go ahead. Say what you're gonna say.
Okay, so I'm gonna say is that it's like he's new to DC this time. I feel like he doesn't understand. Back. Star Labs to tell the writers a different thing, because to me, like, my recollection of this time period of Star Labs is that they were they showed up a lot in the New Teen Titans, and in the New Teen Titans, like, the stuff that Star Labs was doing was some very like cutting edge type of research and stuff like that, and I believe they always had like the security was was a lot of the Reddit cops.
Yeah, right. You would think they wouldn't have the Keystone cops on security at this super high tech place where they've got fucking kryptonite and shit like that on lockdown. I mean, I remember Star Labs also, I think, from the Superman titles, because I feel like Superman did interact with them quite a bit also. That's interesting about Teen Titans, though. Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, well, the presentation here for security there is pretty sad, and Shockwave breaks on through there very quickly here at the beginning of issue 2 of Blue Devil, and then we cut back to Blue Devil, who is just getting used to being kind of a quasi-celebrity. He's got people rushing him in the streets because, 8-foot-tall Blue Devil running around town, and everyone wants a piece of him, and... Actually, just to give Paris Cullins props for a quick second here, too, again, incredible panel at the top of page 6, which we'll definitely put in our artwork video for the episode, too. But it's one of those awesome comic book panels where you see a character doing some kind of acrobatic, and there's like 19 versions of the character kind of in
it's
like sort of
like there's something.
I don't even know what you call this in comic art, but it's like a tried and true artistic trope that I love in comics, where you see him doing all the actions and the moves and the flips in sort of like, lighter sort of background visual version of the art before the full blown image of him jumping at you. I'm doing a terrible job of describing it, but you're looking at the panel, Chris. I don't know if there's a better way to explain that, but it's an amazing panel here at the top of page 6.
Yeah. Hold on, because there's a name for this type of art. I mean, this type of panel thing, it's called...
It's like you see every bit of his jump as he's jumping towards you. You see him in all of the motions immediately prior to that jump as he's leaping off a building, flying through the air, doing a somersault, twisting back around. I mean, Paris Cullins is working so friggin' hard on just this one panel that it's unbelievable. I mean, for the page rate he must have been getting, I mean, this is amazing work.
All right. So I found out what it's called. This is called the DeLuca effect.
Oh, interesting.
Is the name of that technique? Yeah. So and Paris.
Wait, where does that come from? Who is that named after? Not Mike DeLuca.
No. I don't know. I happen to see it somewhere on Instagram somewhere like a couple of years ago, and I wrote it down.
Oh yeah,
because like someone had done a bunch of like page grabs of a bunch of different comics and showed it. You know, because like you see it where it's like it's done like that fight scene from Old Boy. You know, like when they're in the
right.
You know, so there's a bunch of different ways of doing it, but it's
wow. Oh my God, that's fucking fascinating. I've been seeing that effect in comics my whole life. I never knew it had a name.
Yeah.
Damn.
So it's, yeah, which is pretty cool. So, but the cool thing about it is that Paris Cullins, he does such a really, really amazing job at it because he's got so many versions of Blue Devil. I mean, he's got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21. He's got
it's crazy. It's insane. I've never seen a DeLuca effect really in one panel with this many iterations of the character. It's complete insanity.
He's got 20, he's got 15, 20 of them or something like that before he even gets to the main like image of the guy, which is, you know, so hats off to him for what he can do.
Fucking crazy. I'm nominating Paris Cullins for panel of the year for 1984. I mean, I don't know what the competition is in 84. I'm sure he's got some stiff competition. But man, this has to be one of the best panels in a DC comic in 84. It's incredible. It's really amazing. And I'm so glad that I've learned what this is called now. And I'm reading online about present day artist Bruno Redondo and the magic of his DeLuca effect in Nightwing 87, which is awesome. This is a technique that survives to this day in comics. And look at that. We're all learning things about comics here together.
Yeah. Yeah. It's pretty amazing. It's pretty amazing. I mean, to me, the thing I love with this panel is, though, is that his perspective of the buildings is so striking, and he's able to do good perspective with each of the little figures in that, you know, that are making up the DeLuca effect. I mean, look, for a guy, I'm not sure, I can't remember what this guy's his resume was, but
oh, it was minimal, very minimal at this point. He was a young artist,
so you know, I mean, but. But he's getting like he's showing he's got a lot of skills. I think we also said, you know, that a different inker was doing issue one. So issue two is now inked by Gary Martin, and you can tell that that it's just a lot more. I don't know. It feels tighter. Everything feels,
yes.
You know, which is pretty awesome about the work that he's doing. So at this point, like Blue Devil. He's still struggling to get rid of the suit. He can't figure it out. He's just walking on the street. Again, this feels like a Spider-Man thing when he's like walking around as Spider-Man, like not before J. Jonah starts fucking with people, you know. And he's just trying to figure out what it is. I think what's interesting about this is that he goes to this bar where people know who he is because it's like, feels like it's old hat for him to show up in a costume from his movie. You know, like to go at a bar, which is weird.
Oh, yeah, that's a good point. Right. So people are like, great costume, Danny.
Yeah, they know it's him, which is weird because it's like nobody, like people don't wear their costumes from a movie set. I go, what?
Their 8-foot blue devil costume with giant horns. Yeah, I think it's a little odd that the people at the bar react as if it's normal for him.
But I'll tell you a funny story. I will tell you a funny story about who had to wear their costume because they left set and didn't have time to change. So there's a really, really funny story where when Orson Welles was filming Touch of Evil, you know, and like the big fat guy Quinlan, and he sort of got like a fat suit on and like a lot of like makeup to make him
look
sweaty and dirty, stuff like that. And he said he had to rush to a dinner one day and he didn't have to... he take any of it off. And he sat down and got the dinner, stuff like that. And some studio exec said, Wells, you're looking great these days. And he was like, what the fuck, man? I'm still in costume. So it's like,
I'm in a fat suit.
Yeah, I'm in a fat suit. And I look sloppy. So like a fat drunk. And you tell me I look good. you know, but but it just goes to let you show much how much people didn't like him. So, but anyway.
Oh, that's funny.
I think what's funny about this story now is, you know, he's coming home and he owns this brownstone that he's like, I own like the one floor and I'm living up there, but I don't.
Yeah. Yeah. That's kind of random too. He's like this special effects kind of like prop guy stuntman in the movies. And okay, I guess you can make some good money doing that. But it seems kind of random that he's like a landlord with his own brownstone. But not for long here.
Well, yeah, it's a brownstone that, you know, he's renting out. It's an apartment building. He's renting out floors. So,
yeah.
But see, again, it's like this is 83, 84. Right?
It's 84, yeah.
This is before, I mean, not to say it wasn't always crazy. Actually, for a long time, the prices for stuff wasn't so out of control in New York right now. This feels like it might be like in the Bronx or Brooklyn. So it's feasible that a person could have bought a brownstone, you know, to rent out, you know. But it's crazy because, like, he's a phone call.
Okay.
And she's like, hey, man, like we're trying to, you like, I mean, she's getting pressed at this point. Maybe not now, but she starts getting pressed about he can't wear that suit in public because it's going to mess up.
And Marla's
the director, producer, the director.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah. So there's kind of this. I think there's a really weird. There's like a C story like in these first issues where, you know, they shot the movie down in the island where the Bureaus is, and they actually were shooting during all this battle, so they have footage to make a real monster movie, and the financier film studio guy's tripping out. He's trying to sue Blue Devil or sue the girl Marla because he's like exposing, like it's like an intellectual property like lawsuit that he's dealing with because he's showing what the monster's gonna look like in this upcoming movie.
It's really weird. It's a weird plot point for things to kind of turn upon here. But yeah, it kind of is like, I guess, like, hey, man, like you signed an NDA to make this movie for us, right? And like, it's like you designed this crazy new Iron Man suit or whatever. You can't be running around New York getting photographed in this Iron Man suit we paid you money for. You know, you're going to spoil the movie, basically. And that's kind of the vibe. Yeah, it's kind of funny. And Marla's like, hey, you got to get out of the suit because, you know, Mr. Werner says so. And it's, you know, obviously a play on like Warner Brothers. But instead of Warner Brothers, it's like Werner Brothers. Yeah. And, you know, and Dan's like, what the fuck, man? I don't really have a choice here. Like, my skin and my body have melded with this suit. And, you know, he went to go see a doctor and we see a flashback here in this issue of it. And the doctor says, incredible, the latex costume has become organic material and bonded to your own skin. Blood vessels and nerves have grown into it. And Dan says, yeah, doc, it's astounding. So what can you do about it? And, you know, and he's like, it isn't a costume anymore. It's him.
Yeah.
And that's very, very interesting. And that's why Dan's going to the bar to drown his sorrows in alcohol. But then when he does end up going back home to his brownstone, here's one of those big coincidences that, you know, perhaps is awfully convenient when it comes to the world of comic book writing here, where it just so happens that Dan Cassaday and his brownstone that he owns are right in the path of supervillain Shockwave. And Shockwave, in the middle of his crime spree at Star Labs here, ends up just destroying Dan's brownstone, just randomly destroying that building that Blue Devil happens to be housed inside of. And Blue Devil falls out of it. And then this is what causes him to get into a big fight with Shockwave. And it is, you know, very much like that Spider-Man vibe you're saying, Chris. It's super casual. Blue Devil's like, oh man, did you have to go and wreck my building? Couldn't you have picked another neighborhood to play cops and robbers in? And Shockwave says, I play where I want to play, Pally. Who or what are you? And Blue Devil's like, yo, man, I'm not a superhero. Leave me alone. Leave me alone. And then Shockwave smacks him and Blue Devil gets pissed. And he says, that was a cheap shot. Cheap shot. I'm no superhero. and I didn't ask for this, but you just bought yourself a world of hurt. And suddenly, his next big superhero fight has come to him.
Yeah, I mean, the fight pretty much lasts the rest of the issue. But the thing that I find interesting is that that woman from Star Labs shows up, and she tells him, you know, he stole some synthetic kryptonite, so you have to get that back. And there's an interesting little panel that the woman's like, and he's like, and he kind of referencing Superman, and she's like, yeah, Superman knew that we were creating some kryptonite, he'd be kind of fucking pissed if he. You know,
yes, that's right. Yes.
Yeah, which is kind of an interesting, again, another subplot, which is a good subplot that he's setting up, you know, or that the two guys are setting up. You know, the fight is a good fight. The fight feels like one of these good fights of like two guys who don't know how to fight are fighting, you know, which I think is kind of cool about it. I think it's cool. This is page 15 when he gets electrocuted. Some great, what do they call that stuff again? The damn Kirby crackle, which I think is kind of cool.
Oh, yeah, yeah. There you go. Yeah. A little Kirby crackle, which is presaging Paris Cullins one day relaunching New Gods in the future. Definitely has some big, big Jack Kirby influence going on with Paris Cullins. I think you can definitely see that in the energy of his artwork. By the way, speaking of the DeLuca effect, Chris, now that you've named this phenomenon, or you've told me the name of it, it's pretty wild to see how much Paris Cullins is using the DeLuca effect in this fight scene throughout issue number 2, because we see it again at the bottom of page 16. It's another DeLuca effect while Blue Devil's fighting Shockwave.
Yeah,
you see it there. And then once again on page 18. And the one on page 18 is another pretty freaking crazy DeLuca effect. It's 10, 11, 12? It's like 11 or 12 Dan Cassidy's in one panel executing a crazy move where he's bending a streetlight pole in the middle of a fight and swinging around it. I mean, man, Paris Cullins is going to town with these DeLuca effects, man. This is like he bet somebody he could fit three of them in one issue, and he does it.
Yeah, I mean, it's crazy because, I mean, but the thing is, though, you bring it up with the Jack Kirby, like, it's a way for him to get the energy of a Kirby, like, kind of page layout without knowing how to do the real kind of Kirby. I mean, like, if you go to the again, was that page 18 or was that page? Yeah, 18. Like those bottom three panels. That's straight up Kirby right there. Like those three, you know. But
oh yeah. Oh, you're right. Oh, big time. Yes, where Shockwave gets shocked by the loose electrical pole, and yeah, it's like literally those look like they could be Kirby panels. A couple of them.
Yeah, and it's weird because it's like a lot of people love Kirby, you know, rightfully so. But it's like not many people were really able to like he creates a level of movement in the way he creates some of the panel designs and stuff like that, the layouts, that it's sort of hard to replicate. I feel it's the composition and the very strict like 4, 6, or 9 panel layouts or whatever it is. It's really smart. I mean, but Paris Cullins, but. Again, this fight lasts a long time, but it doesn't feel repetitive or too slow. And here on page 20, the real puppet master is showing up, you know, and then the Shockwave gets tractor beamed away, and then once again, here's some more DeLuca effect on page 21.
Yeah, you're right. Another three panels of it. Wow.
Where he steals the synthetic kryptonite that Shockwave had. It's too late for Shockwave, you know, to escape the thing he's in, you know. So, but he's like, but you know what? He's basically saying, we're not done. We're gonna fight again, but I can't fight you now, you know. And then he meets the ruler from Star Labs, and you know, and then he gets served with the subpoena to take that suit off.
Yeah, which is really funny. It's a little comedy here. We're an actual lawyer. Some just sort of weaselly little lawyer dude runs up on Dan Cassidy after this big superhero fight, and he just says, "Mr. Daniel Cassidy, the Superior Court of Metropolis County, acting on behalf of Marla Bloom Associates and Werner Brothers Films, hereby enjoins you from any further public displays of the Blue Devil suit, which is the sole property of... And Dan's like, you can't do this. And he grabs the attorney and he hangs him from the top of a telephone pole by his suit and leaves him struggling, tells him to stuff it, and walks away. So a little comedy here with the attorney stuck hovering off the ground. He's not harmed, and his suit is just getting fucked up. But Dan Cassidy, aka Blue Devil, he's apparently going to be a different type of superhero. He's irreverent, and he doesn't care about getting sued.
Not at all. And so that brings me into issue two. Issue three is now it's not Blue Devil, it's versus Metallo. Metallo, he's like, fuck it, I want that kryptonite. It's weird because, like, Metallo, I didn't read a lot of DC books until after Crisis.
And, right.
And Metallo, his first appearance post-Crisis was in John Byrne's The Man of Steel. And he was a different, he wasn't like this.
Oh, yeah. Because Byrne reimagined so much in Man of Steel. That's right. His Metallo is very different. Yeah, this old school Metallo. Yeah, he was a little before my time, too. But I did see him here and there in back issues I'd pick up. And, you know, for those who don't know, Metallo is like a green metallic kind of android looking, quasi Iron Man looking dude who is powered by a kryptonite heart. He was known as Metallo, the man with the kryptonite heart. And for a while, when I was a kid, I kind of thought of him as like a pretty serious Superman villain. Maybe not A-list, but like B-plus list Superman villain, because he's got a fucking kryptonite heart. I mean, you know, he's deeply dangerous to Superman. But yeah, and then John Byrne reinvented him, I think made him a little bit more of a serious character in a certain way. But yeah, I don't know. I feel like Metallo, I guess... Yeah, I don't know that he ever resonated as much with people. Like, he wasn't ever like a Lex Luthor level menace. And, you know, and here, frankly, he comes off as kind of a clown in the sense that, you know, he can't beat Blue Devil, who just, you know, started superheroing, you know, the other day. But, you know, it's an intriguing little showdown here between Dan and Metallo.
Yeah, well, it's kind of weird that he's depicted, like you said, like a clown, because it's like he does. I mean, he should be I believe he's like, yeah, you're right. He's a B plus Superman villain, but he almost needs to be, even in this incarnation, he needs to be an A-list one because, you know, unlike anyone else, he's got Superman's weakness built into him. So his power.
Yeah.
His power, for him to even operate, Superman is weak. And that's what's kind of cool about it. But, you know, but he doesn't have any real kryptonite. He's trying to get the synthetic kryptonite, which, you know, he found out this, you know, that was being made in Star Labs. So issue three is more Star Labs is trying to figure out if they can take the suit off Blue Devil. They obviously can't because that's how it is. But he gets this feeling about there's a little small cameo of a fucking Nibiros in this just for a moment as he's recapping like what happens to him. But well, we get back to Metallo and Shockwave and they're like, we gotta invade Star Labs and get this thing, and Metallo was so pissed at fucking Shockwave, he's like, no, you stay here because I can't trust you to fight Mel anymore.
right, because Shockwave, we realize, was actually Metallo's goon, and yeah. He was kind of like Metallo's henchman. And Shockwave's fucked it all up. So Metallo's like, you know, you can't hire any good help these days. I got to take care of this myself. And Metallo's got a certain melodramatic way of speaking, which also, you know, props to Mishkin and Cohn. Metallo sounds different than Shockwave. Shockwave sounded more like the Rhino. You know, he was like a Ben Grimm kind of street level sort of character, you know, neighborhood guy, where Metallo is more like, fool, you should have fled when you had the chance. I'll rend you limb for limb. You know, he's a little bit more of a, I think he sees himself in more of a Shakespearean vein, which is kind of funny because Metallo is inherently pretty goofy looking.
Yeah, I mean, he totally.
I'm sorry. He just talks funny. You dare to mock me? Then let us see you spout witticisms when your breath is crushed from your windpipe. you know, so yeah, he's a character, this Metallo.
He's funny. He's funny. So, you know, so Metallo, so, and we catch a little glimpse of Clark Kent. Gets that's when he gets information about this thing at Star Labs and all thing with the kryptonite. The super country of kryptonite, you know. And then we're back to the thing with Marla getting sued, pressured by the guy. Now, here's the interesting thing is that now Sharon, the girl, the actress who the Blue Devil risked his life for to actually become Blue Devil by mistake, and this guy named Norm, the cameraman, they both come to New York, kind of like talk some sense into Dan Cassidy. And it's kind of fun, or well, not Norm, but he's taking the girl, Sharon, to the airport, you know. And so then she's going to fly to New York, and she's going to try to meet Blue Devil. And I'm not sure if she's going to try to talk some sense to him on some level. But then right when Blue Devil's almost finished up with, you know, his prognosis or diagnosis or scanning, testing at Star Labs, that's when the invasion happens the home invasion of Star Labs by Metallo's goons. And then it's this big fight. It's this big fight with Metallo and Blue Devil, and Metallo's like, you fool, and, you know, and he feeds him, so, and he gets the kryptonite and he feeds it, you know, and he's getting super strong. And then there's a cool moment where with Blue Devil, he gets shot, seemingly killed, you know, like on page 11 or something like this. And you see all the circuitry and everything like that is all exposed. But what's crazy is, next thing you know, there's Metallo. He's like, he's got the kryptonite. Superman's flying. Superman's like, oh, I can't get in there because I can feel the kryptonite. Here's the thing about, like, I never understood. Well, kryptonite is like, it's a radioactive isotope from the planet Krypton, right? So it's just whatever. It's like uranium from Krypton, or just pieces of the planet.
That
because it exploded, what survived is now isotope. But it's interesting how with when Metallo has it in himself to feed him, there's like a field given off. Because there's that page on page 12 where it's like Superman. He's like, oh, I have to like detour where I can't even fly into Star Lab. This is just too dangerous for me. Which means it's
right.
This means it's all of the Blue Devil. And then here on page 13, he heals. Like that panel, that little three-panel thing where the circuitry heals up and he gets solid. That's kind of cool. It was something that, like, you know, I didn't suspect. He didn't suspect. I think it's a good shock to the audience. It's like, oh, you see the circuitry where he's been blown up. So he's not flesh and blood. He is some weird combination of flesh and blood and circuits.
Yeah, and I think it's so fascinating because it also sort of harkens back to the title of the letter column of Blue Devil, which, as you may have noticed, is Circuits and Sorcery.
Yeah.
And I think that's like a really interesting sort of distillation, microcosm, if you will, of the whole Blue Devil thing. Is that it's this weird combination of human ingenuity and technology, i.e. the circuitry, and like this curse of a demon and, you know, the sorcery of the demon realm. So, yeah, it's a really unique combination of elements. You know, the phrase mashup didn't exist in 1984, but if it did, you could call Blue Devil a mashup of like, kind of like a techno adventure story or a techno thriller with like some kind of weird occult dark magic story thrown in a blender with a superhero story. It is a unique combination of elements, you know, and again, props to DC, props to Jeanette Kahn, Dick Giordano. Like, as you were saying in that meanwhile column that you quoted from at the beginning of this episode, Chris, DC was willing to take chances here on genres that were not your typical superhero story here. And the Blue Devil origin, I think, is a very unique origin story. It's not your usual superhero origin tale. And I love it, Matt. It's just such a fun, original thing. And, you know, we're just getting little pieces of what it's all about. They haven't given away all the secrets just yet, which is really cool.
No, I think you made an interesting point about the mashup and the sorcery with the circuits. I'm trying to think if there was any other kind of superhero that did that prior to this, because I'm sure you have Iron Man, you have Doctor Strange, you have Dr. Fate, you have...
But they were like separate worlds, right?
Yeah, it's there's not that much like, hey, let's have the magic exist in the technology.
It's kind of like those, like, it was sort of like Never the Twain Shall Meet, because like, yeah, Tony Stark, Iron Man, I'm in a world of like robotic technological suits and science and shit. And then Stephen Strange, Doctor Strange, I'm in these surreal, psychedelic, Ditko-esque, you know, Ditko-drawn, like, mindscapes, you know, hallucinatory landscapes of, you know, crazy explosions of imagination. But we see that exact thing here in Blue Devil coming up soon in these next couple issues when Dan goes and links up with Zatanna. And I know we'll get to that in a second, but he enters Nibiru's dimension. And it's straight out of Doctor Strange. It's straight out of Ditko. It's like that kind of wild world. But yeah, you know, I obviously wasn't thinking this when I was a kid reading Blue Devil. But looking back at it now, it actually is kind of fascinating that these guys, Mishkin and Cohn and Paris Cullins, that they mashed up these elements the way they did. It's really cool. It's really original. And, you know, like we said, they're coming off of Amethyst Princess of Gem World with Ernie Colon, which was the other regular Mishkin and Cohn joint from DC. And that was straight up magic, straight up fantasy. And so they were obviously comfortable in the realms of magic and just all that kind of storytelling. But they took that and they combined it here with the more modern technology of the DCU, Star Labs, etc. And yeah, you know, it's really cool. It makes me wish that we'd seen more Mishkin and Cohn original creations at DC, because I think they had a really unique vibe for what they were doing.
For sure. That's the thing about this book. This issue, it does something cool because you're seeing how Metallo is a tech creature, and he's fighting this Blue Devil who's really a sorcery creature, who's got some tech blend, and it shows you that the sorcery is able to defeat the technology. And that was it too, because who was it? Was it Asimov or Ray Bradbury or one of those guys that said a long time ago, you know, that magic is just technology that we don't understand yet. You know?
Yes. I think it was Asimov. It was that quote about any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic.
Yeah.
So I think that was it.
But it just shows you that this technology of man, that of Metallo, it's of no match to the powers that Blue Devil got from the demon Nibiru. And that's why he's able to defeat Metallo and he's able to steal it. I mean, when he grabs his heart out of his chest, that's not
good. that's pretty cold. That's some pretty cold stuff right there for your winning moment.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. You know, and then he's there with the woman from Star Labs, and then somehow Superman is able to show up. And I guess Superman is able to show up because with Metallo being defeated and the kryptonite being pulled out of him, the energy field's not being emitted. It's just like whatever the radiation, you know. Well, you know, it's funny.
Yeah.
So when I was watching that Chernobyl, like the miniseries Chernobyl.
Yeah.
I was talking about how like the radiation is like It's like bullets, right? And it's like, it's atoms going so fast at you like a bullet that, you know, that's how you get flood radiation poisoning, because the ice tips come at you that fast. And it's so basically like anything radioactive is sending off. It's the electrons. The electrons are being thrown off like this hyper speed. Again, I'm just trying to like apply like physics to my old brain, to nuclear physics, to how fucking kryptonite works.
well, I'm quite sure that the story of Blue Devil will line up exactly with the laws of physics as we know them.
I don't know why I'm doing that, but I'm just thinking about, because it's one thing I've always find curious about kryptonite. I'm like, well, what is it? I mean, is it whatever. But at the end of this issue, Superman shows up and he's like, I'm gonna take that kryptonite, and then I'm gonna take you, Blue Devil, to some place where you need some help. And then they fly off right when Sharon, the actress, arrives. She's like, hey, Dan, where are you? And it's too late because Superman is flying off with Blue Devil.
Yeah. And that's it, right? That's the end of issue three,
right? So I wonder if we kind of combine.
Yeah, I think we can combine 4 and 5 because they really are one
2-part story. So yes. Yeah. So basically, you know, at the end of Blue Devil 3, he's like, I'm a Superman. He's hoping to find some cure to his thing. And what's really dope is the title of issue 4 is, you know, and this is something that they don't do anymore, is that they put these weird text boxes on cover, but it says, do you dare enter the house of Nibirios? He's still hungry. And then we go into the episode. Now, what he takes us to the JLA satellite, where Superman shows Blue Devil around and he introduces him to not, what's his name? Demby? Ralph?
Oh, it's the Elongated Man.
Yeah, the Elongated Man. He's, you know, and those guys talk. He realizes, he explains to him about the situation about. He tries to arm wrestle Superman. Like, dude, you're not strong. Like,
well, like, it's funny, though. It is charming because Dan's actually trying to figure out how strong he is in this devil suit. And he's kind of like, what better opportunity to find out how strong I am than arm wrestling the Man of Steel? You know, because I think I'm pretty strong. But, you know, Superman, help me gauge exactly how strong I am. And Superman's like, are you sure about that, buddy? So he's like, and then Elongated Man's like, come on, Supes, have some fun. Why not? And so Superman's like, all right, I guess. But then he predictably, he sends Blue Devil flying across the JLA satellite. And we have confirmation Blue Devil is strong, but he's no Superman when it comes to super strength.
And then they get a little like, I guess they called Zatanna, or maybe she's just, she says she's interrupting. So,
actually, but then I think Superman says, Dan Cassidy, this is Zatanna. She's the one I thought could help you with your problem. So I guess there's some indication that he had reached out to her somehow.
Right. Now, here's what's funny, though, right? Here's what's funny. Even though now, because she's a magician and sort of dabbles in the occult, even here on page 4 in that last panel, right? Look at her body language, the way she's drawn. She's sort of showing she's attracted to him, even though, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's a weird.
Yeah. I mean, it's funny because there's definitely romantic tension between Dan Cassidy, Blue Devil, and Zatanna right from the beginning. Yeah, and you could see that, and, you know, Dan's quite the charmer. He says to her, you know, there aren't many women who could get away with wearing a bug on their head, but on you, it looks terrific. And, of course, she has, like, kind of like a red magical scarab, like, scarab beetle thing as part of her headdress. And, you know, it looks like Dan makes Zatanna blush here with his smooth talking. She's like, why, thank you. I think that was a compliment. It sure was. But you're right, based on the body language, like, it does kind of seem like they're into each other. And, you know, I think that's foreshadowing something that we're going to get to by the end of this 2-issue story arc.
Right. So then, you know, Zatanna, she tries to use some magic to remove the suit. She can't. And then she brings up this demon encyclopedia to find out about about Nibiru's. And what's cool is that 6 and 7 is a really cool, you know, like as a spread. It's a double page spread to show the history of Nibiru's and how he got, you know, like sent away and banished and stuff like that. And his old people used to worship him. But what's really funny is somehow this tome has been updated to show how Nibiru's like showed up and like and had this sort of run in with Blue Devil. And it's updating. It's like a, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's like, what's the guy from Sandman? Destiny, the Endless Brother, who's writing the book about what's happening. It's like this book is updating to tell you the most recent entry with Nibiru's is now this recent thing with his running with the Blue Devil. Because the Blue Devil is showing up, Dan Cassidy as Blue Devil is in the pages of the old encyclopedia.
Which is so cool. Yeah, it's so cool because this just happened like a few days ago in this world. And Dan's like, hey, that's me. What am I doing in there? And she's like, it's a revised edition. They keep updating it. And the book itself is almost like sequential art. Like there is some magical sort of hieroglyphics, I guess, scrawled on the pages. But it's largely just these huge, very beautifully drawn sequential images that Paris Cullins is drawing in kind of a more storybook, old-timey style to separate it from the world of our story. But yeah, they're really beautifully drawn sequential images taking us through Nibiru's story, going back to the days of Atlantis, and then all the way up to the present day and his latest battle with our friend Dan Cassidy, aka Blue Devil. And then Zatanna's like, all right, well, you know, only Nibiru's can turn back the spell that's got you stuck in this suit. So we're going to have to go ask him to do it. And Blue Devil's like, what? Like, excuse me? And so then she's like, yeah, we got to go back to the island and back to the place where you banished Nibiru's back into his demon realm. And you got to go back there and, you know, let's go talk to Nibiru's and see, like, maybe you can just reason with him.
She's like, and he's like, are you crazy? And it's funny because we, the audience, know that Nibiru's is absolutely insane.
and highly unreasonable.
Yeah, completely unreasonable. So they're ready to go to the island. That's when the Marla says to the cattle man, Norm, I need you to go back to the island and film like some pickup B-roll for me.
Oh, yeah, at the same time.
Which I think is fucking over with. So then, you know, they use the satellite from JLA to flash down to this island. They show up at the island. They show up at the old temple. And then they, you know, and then they go into the temple. And then they're like, you got to go through this doorway.
This is my favorite part. Because Zatanna's like, I'm going to guard the doorway. So Dan, you go on in to Nibiru's his hellscape, his crazy demon dimension that he rules. You go in there and talk to Nibiru's and like, you work out this shit. I'll be right here guarding the passageway. And he's like, what the fuck? And she's like, come on.
He's like, wait a minute. You're the magic user. I'm
This is crazy. This is terrifying.
It's funny. I mean, it's weird scripting is because it's sort of like if you were writing this like today or this wasn't as I don't say tongue in cheek, but I guess it is a little tongue in cheek. She would need a reason why. She's like, look, for me to keep the doorway from collapsing, I got to stay here.
Yes. Yeah, that's a good solve. That's actually a really good solve, Chris, because it does seem bizarre that she's just like, OK, have fun. I'll be right here waiting for you. And I know you're not used to this superhero stuff. You're just a regular dude who got stuck in a suit. But good luck negotiating with an ancient demon. You know, like it's pretty nuts.
So, you know, so like you said, you know, he goes into the role of Nibiru's. And you're right. This looks totally out of a fucking Doctor Strange book. This looks totally like the Dark Dimension where Dormammu and what's it, Umar? Is that her name? Yeah.
I don't know her name, but yeah, I know Dormammu or whatever that guy's name is.
Yeah, he's got a sister. Her name is like Umar, something like that. I can't remember. She got black hair. She's not flamey like he is. I mean, he's not befriending me either. Like, he used to look like a regular dude, but somehow he got some power boost. That's why his face is on fire like that. I don't know all the Marvel stuff anymore. I'm sure someone's going to correct me, but it's something like that. So Cassidy, he goes in to try to find, you know, Nibiru's, and Nibiru's is like, it's you, brother.
Thank you. Yeah.
You've changed your mind.
I love this. I love this shit. I love that they pick up the joke, which was so funny, I thought, from the first issue, where Nibiru's somehow, even though he's this all-powerful demon, he's completely fooled by Dan Cassidy's devil suit. And Nibiru's actually believes still that Dan is a real demon. And he's like, oh, little brother, it is you. Nibiru's welcomes you to his realm. So you've had a change of heart and you've come to share your world with Nibiru's. And Dan's like, no, not exactly. Well, Nibiru's accepts this most generous offer and forgives his dear brother for past transgressions. How glorious! Nibiru's will rule the earth again with a brother demon at his side! Like, Nibiru's is so hyped to see Dan. It's wild. Nibiru's is like popping champagne. He's like fucking excited. That's crazy.
Like we said, he's unreasonable as shit. You know, and what's crazy is that he's got that trident, which is really Dan's trident.
Yes.
The first issue. And somehow he's like put some power or some magical spell into it. And those guys get in a fight, you know, because he's like, I kind of need you to get this. He's like, you've cursed me. I'm going to need you to take this curse off. And they get in a fight to fight all this through. And he's like,
Dan says that. Dan wants the suit taken off him.
Yeah, yeah. And the Bruce is like, but the doorway is open. I'm going to go through now and fucking eat your world and bring you with me so you can watch me eat your world, you know. And that's when Zatanna is like, oh shit, here he is. You know, I can't keep him at bay. And they just get it's more of these kind of like interesting kind of like fights they do. And he's really good at doing the fight layouts and how they fight. But what's really cool is, it is weird, right? It's like the architecture inside this temple castle. That face looks sort of like Easter Island type of situation.
Oh, sure. Okay.
It's an interesting mishmash of ancient societies within this, which I think is pretty cool. You know, they're just fighting and they're trying to keep him inside. You know, and then we cut out to Norm and he's like, you know, hey, what's going on? The helicopter guy's there, the cinematographer. And he's like, oh shit, he sees fucking Nibiru's too and he gets PTSD, you know, but then Nibiru's takes the helicopter down by throwing the trident at the tail. Which, in all honesty, would cause that thing to explode. So, but
yeah,
it does crash. But whatever. It's just like,
let's not quibble over the Blue Devil physics. I also don't believe Norm would have gone back to the island after the last time he was there. Like, this is some level of devotion to his job that this camera guy has.
Yeah, it's crazy. It's like no money, no nothing, but. But what's cool here is that when they're out here, Zatanna figures out that he's afraid of water. That
Nibiru's is.
Yeah, Nibiru's somehow it harms him. I'm not really sure like where he gets that idea from. But you know what's really cool? This is a pet, was it? This is page 22. The top panel on page 22 is a really cool panel. It's really cool. It's like Nibiru's is menacing the fuck out of them, which is the way they're drawn. Like it's a really smartly drawn. It's that's kind of like expert level composition just on this whole page.
I agree. That's actually a great page. And Nibiru's looking creepy as hell throughout that whole page. Like some really inspired Nibiru's design, but also kind of physical acting. I'm actually kind of amazed at how well Paris Cullins is able to twist the body of Nibiru's, this bizarre insectoid reptilian demon creature, the way he's able to twist his anatomy into different shapes, and like even when he takes off riding the trident in the sky in the bottom panel on the page, like it feels like Paris Cullins really has like a sense of Nibiru's anatomy, which is quite impressive, frankly.
Well, yeah, because it's not a human. It's just like, hey, I mean,
yeah,
you know, like, yeah, I'm my own creature. You know, I mean, again, it's like we saw like in issue one, that thing, the silhouette, like he understands this, the design of this creature in a way, which is pretty cool, you know? And then, you know, at the wrap up of issue four is, you know, they're like, oh shit, he's going west, probably to Mexico. And then they take a spell and disappear. And they strand like Norm on the island.
Poor Norm. Dan's like, can't talk now, Norm. We got a demon on the loose. And then he's like, wait for us, Dan.
Oh. You know, then issue five, which is the final issue of this initial story, this initial, like, the opening story arc of the Blue Devil comic is, it's basically, you know, like, they go back up to the satellite, the JLA satellite. They try to figure out like where Nibiru's is. They realize that he's gone to Mexico, and that I guess he's like a Mexican, or he's not a Mexican, but he's like a Central American demon, I guess, or entity, you know, because he kind of knows these people. He feels what it holds. I'm like he understands this. You know,
he remembers. He remembers being there, I guess, back in the day, because he's saying as he's destroying this village here, in the Sierra Madre range, where the little village of Santa Guadalupe is nestled between the remarkable pair of flat top peaks, an ancient evil has returned. This is what the captions say. For buried beneath 6,000 years of ancestral memories, a nightmare has haunted these simple Indians. That's what the text says here. I'm not sure if that would be the text today. That might be a bit problematic.
Well, I mean, it might say that, or it might say the Aztecs, or you know, I mean, I guess.
Yeah, I think the phrase simple Indians probably would not fly today.
They wouldn't say simple Indians, but they might say, you know, what do they say? I might say these native. But here's the thing that I like is that he's like, it's on page two, he's like, where are the worshippers? Where is the temple? You know, Nibiru.
He's not pleased. Yeah, that's right. He's saying that as he's like destroying a village.
Yeah, but it just makes you think that he's like, oh yeah, like these two mesas or whatever they are. Like he's like, oh, this is where I was from, and he causes like a volcano or whatever.
Yeah,
to explode. It feels sort of like the Mount Vesuvius type of volcano. It's not really lava based, you know. But then like Zatanna and Blue Devil show up here. And they're like trying to fight off these people. But what's funny is, you know, like the Mexican army comes to fight him, you know, to fight off the Nibiru's. And it's like, they're never going to get any kind of like they're going to get fucked with him.
No. Like you said, in the world of Blue Devil, magic trumps technology. And so, you know what I mean? And I got to respect that. You know, I think that makes a lot of sense to me that an ancient demon has more firepower than, you know, whatever military we're going to throw at him. And you know, props to Mishkin and Cohn once again for having yet another voice for this villain here in Nibiru's. Nibiru sounds nothing like Metallo. Metallo sounds nothing like Shockwave. And Nibiru's voice is so charming with his just outrage that you're almost rooting for him, because, like, he just, like, he's fun to read. You know, as he's destroying this village, he's just constantly screaming and ranting. And he's saying, Nibiru's will reclaim this land. He will be restored to his rightful place and former glory. He will rule these fleas as did their forebears. Here, where Nibiru's secondary temple stood until the accursed mystics laid him low and ended all his works. Here will he rebuild his new capital, which shall be the center of this world once these quiet peaks spewed forth their violent rage. And now, with the might of this wondrous trident, like, he is a talker. He is a gabby-ass demon. Like, this is a yakety-yakin demon. But, you know, I kind of love it. Like, he's got some good banter. He's funny. Like, who is he talking to here, really? Like, he's literally just talking to himself the whole time. Like, the villagers are running and screaming. And, like, he's just ranting. I mean, yeah, I kind of got to respect it. I sort of love Nibiru's. You know, he's really, really fun as far as demons go.
here's the thing too, though. Like so the devil pays spread on page 8 and 9. You know, he's raised the temple from Earth is like one of the coolest temple designs I've seen. Like, it's fucking awesome.
Oh, yeah. Agreed. It's amazing. I mean, really, Paris Cullins just kills it. Like, I don't know if he spent, you know, how many days on drawing this, but it looks beautiful.
I mean, he probably, I would wager to guess that he did this layout and just, you know, and he kept coming back to it. Like, you know, if I would do the rest of the book, and would come back and do like a little bit of this and do more pages. You know what I'm saying? Because it'd probably be too much to him to do. You know, like, he's probably fucking his deadline, you know? Like, I don't know. I mean, that's what I would do.
Yeah, yeah. No, you're right. It's super impressive. I mean, it's a really great double page spread. And, I mean, it's rare that a demonic palace can conjure, I think, the necessary wonder or, you know, eeriness or, you know, just kind of look as captivating and otherworldly as you would imagine such a thing would look. But I gotta say, man, like, yeah, I agree with you, Chris. I think Paris Cullins and Gary Martin, I think they kill it on this palace design. This is really just, it's something else. I mean, it is Kirby-esque in a certain way, but also it's got like an original spin on it, though. It doesn't look like it was just Kirby. It looks like wherever they're drawing the influence from, it looks unique.
It's very unique. It's not blocky the way Kirby stuff would be. It's not like heavy, you know, like Kirby stuff feels like it's very this still is very sleek. The way it's colored too is pretty fucking cool too. I mean, I was like, damn, like, this is a really lot of detail. Yeah, it's pretty crazy. I mean, this episode, I love the title. It's called Viva Nibirios. Yes.
And again, man, just the sheer fun factor of Blue Devil. Like, what a fun comic. Viva Nibiros. I mean, just like I was just saying, he's a lovable, monstrous, you know, homicidal demon. Like, he's really, in his way, quite charming. So I think even the writers feel that way with the title, Viva Nibiros. And I got to say, too, you're right about the coloring. The coloring is beautiful on this demon palace. And we should give ample credit to the colorist, who is no longer our friend Tom Zucco. But with this issue, or maybe with the previous one, it looks like we have switched over to Michelle Wolfman, who is the wife of the legendary Marv Wolfman, I'm pretty sure. So yeah. We got Michelle Wolfman on colors.
Here's the thing that I find interesting, right? There's so many, not so many, but there's a lot of artists who's like, husbands are like, you know, pretty well-known creators in the comic field. And then the watch show up as like they do color for them, you know, because I think.
Or for other people in this case, you know, like, yeah.
You know, but I think, but you know, but there's obviously like there's Lynn Varley. There's the, I think you told me that the woman who colors Batman Year One is like.
Yeah. Yeah, Richmond Lewis. Richmond Lewis was married, and I believe still is married, to David Mazzucchelli, and colored his work, almost exclusively in comics. Richmond Lewis, I think, did very little other coloring in comics, because she was a painter herself, and worked largely just with Mazzucchelli. You're right, man. I mean, there's definitely a long history of that in comics. You got Michael and Laura Allred as well.
Right.
Of course, Mike Allred from Mad Men. Laura Allred colors all his work.
Yeah, there's another guy. What's his name? He's he recently did a book with Matt Fraction.
David Aja?
No, not David Aja, but he's and his wife does these. His work is sort of pinup style.
Oh, I know who you're talking about. Terry Dodson.
Yeah, Terry
Dodson. Yeah. Right. Yeah. And his wife also, is his colorist as well. Yeah. Yeah. No, there's a ton of examples of that in the world of comics. And I don't know necessarily, you know, quite how that happens, other than like, you know, it probably just makes sense. And, you know, for a lot of artists who don't want to see their work being kind of bastardized with colors that they did not intend. I'm sure if you have a significant other, a partner who's talented and has like a great eye, I could understand why you wouldn't want to let those pages go to somebody else for that final touch. You know, I could understand why you'd rather keep it in the family and, you know, be able to keep an eye on things and have a bit more control over the color. So yeah, it makes sense. I mean, however, in this case, we see Michelle Wolfman coloring something that has nothing to do with Marv Wolfman, and Lynn Varley and many of these colorists obviously did brilliant work working with other people as well. Witness Lynn Varley's amazing coloring over Trevor Von Eden on that Batman annual number 8. You know, so not to take away anything from any of these colorists who happen to be married to professional artists or whatever, because, you know, clearly a lot of these colorists also have colored tremendous work, you know, not in concert with their significant others.
But the thing I want to say, though, you're absolutely right about all of it, but I thought, did we read somewhere that Lynn Varley was going out with Trevor Von Eden at the time?
Yeah. No, we did touch on that briefly in our thriller episode. But yeah, she and Trevor definitely were a couple. They were a couple before Lynn and Frank were a couple. And you know, I don't know. I don't know the details of it at all. But yeah, no, that's definitely, you know, true.
I'm hazarding the guess that she was dating him the time that she did that Batman. But he did it, and you know
that's possible. I don't want to assume anything because I don't know, but it's certainly possible.
That's why I said I was hazarding the guess.
Yes, you did say that.
So now back to Blue Devil, everyone. So now the Mexican military and Blue Devil and Zatanna are just trying to figure out like how to beat fucking Tiberios, and he's just too fucking. Like he's too powerful. And then, you know, we cut back to the little runner where Marlo's getting pressured about, you know, like by the film producer, you know, like Werner, and she finally tells him to fuck off, which I think is pretty funny, you know, like at this point.
Yes.
You know, and then Nibiros, he summons some demon hordes to beat all the Mexicans, to beat all the Mexican military up. You know, and it just seemed like there's no way for Blue Devil and Zatanna to really win. They can't win in this realm. They have to go and trick him back into his realm, to his temple. But the thing is, though, is that the Blue Devil's like, I want that trident. That's like my trident from, you know, before.
Yes.
And so so he's up here, you know, they're fighting for the trident, you know, they're fighting like, you know, like who can control the trident. And now here's the thing that I found interesting is page 17 of issue 5.
Okay, right. Page 17, yes, we're at the JLA satellite, and, yes. It's not the JLA. Oh, you're right, I'm sorry, it's the Monitor satellite.
Monitor satellite. So this is a year before Crisis, and they're setting it up.
Crisis on Infinite Earths, for those of you not tuned in to what was about to happen here in a major way in the DC Universe, the multiverse shattering maxi series Crisis on Infinite Earths was waiting on deck here, and we were getting little teases in all the DC books at the time, and you're right, Chris, this is one of those little teases, which was very evocative and very you know, intriguing to a young comics fan. I remember being super curious about stuff like this.
But I'm reading this and I'm kind of like, what? I don't remember what. Oh, again, I told you, I didn't read any DC books until after Crisis. Crisis is what got me to reading DC. I was telling David Lindelof this the other day. We were talking, and I was like, yeah, man, the thing that got me into DC was seeing that cover of number 7 of the Death of the Flash. And I was like, what?
I thought you were going to say the Supergirl cover where he's holding Supergirl. No, the Death of the Flash.
Well, yeah, because I was thinking, he and I were talking. I was telling him on the email. I was like, hey, man, I think that part of why Marvel fans were so, like, you know, there was such a demarcation line of who ran what at this time. And I feel like I think that DC books felt a little always youngish.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the Batman show, the live action show with Adam West. And I feel because the Justice, sorry, not just the Super Friends cartoon, which it kind of skewed young. I could skew like 7-8 year olds, you know?
For the multimedia properties, you're right. They were kind of like, they were more youth focused. But also, I think DC in general, and this is what I loved about DC, and still, you know, kind of, I feel like it's, looking back even, I still really do love this about DC, particularly in this era. DC was more whimsical than Marvel. You know, DC was, yeah, we've talked about this, Chris, like DC was more whimsical and just kind of more fun, as you witness Blue Devil here is kind of the apex of that. But I think Marvel also was scarier to me as a kid. Like X-Men was dark as fuck, you know? Like, I remember picking up X-Men when I started reading in 84, and it was some of the J.R. Jr. issues of X-Men where shit was just really just twisted and fucked up and all these terrible things were happening to everyone. And I'd read that, and then I'd read an issue of Blue Devil. And as a 7-year-old kid, Blue Devil was way more my speed. It felt fun, wasn't going to give me nightmares. So yeah, Marvel to me felt more like grown-up comics in a way.
It did. I think that's the thing. I think that, I mean, this is the thing I positioned the name. I said, well, I think it's because what you're saying is that the Marvel books seemed adult, and I feel like a lot of people who read Marvel at that time were kids who wanted to not be to be done with childhood.
Right, yeah, right.
How fast can I get to the adult?
And that, you know, that's a great point, Chris. And I think you're making me realize right in this moment why I was always more of a DC kid, probably because I started reading comics so young at age seven. Yes. You know, it probably would have been impossible on some level for me to become a Marvel kid because there's only so precocious you're going to be. And I think if I'd started reading comics like 5 or 6 years later at like age 13, maybe I would have been more at that point where like, oh, I want to be a grown up and I want to be like, you know, reading dark, cool stuff, you know. But at 7, 8, I mean, like, no, you know, wanted fun comics.
You see, here's the thing though, right? Because when I talk about my younger brother, like he's told me, oh, I remember this book. Like this book scared me as a kid. And I said, like,
yeah.
What are you talking about? You never told me that. But the thing is, he's 5 years younger than me. So I think he was like maybe 5 or 6 reading. And I'm sitting here like bringing out Vigilante and shit.
Yeah, exactly. He'd be like, what the fuck? Don't let that little brother just read the final issue of Vigilante to see what happens to Adrian Chase. Yeah, not for children.
No, there's that. There's like Alpha Flight when Guardian gets killed. But
oh God, yeah.
But the whole thing is that my point I bring this up is the reason is that DC with the Crisis thing is that when you see that Death of the Flash cover, you know,
yeah.
I was like, oh yeah, this is when DC became adult because they killed the Flash, and then I think the 2 issues later is the one with Supergirl when he's holding Supergirl when she's been killed. And it's like, wow, like you guys have now like crossed the Rubicon.
Totally.
Doing, you know.
That's great. I mean, really good point.
Because I sort of think there was an issue. We talked about this. I think it was out and we talked about this at the top of this issue. The maybe it was brought to light. The thing about the Judas contract. The Judas contract with Teen Titans. That's a very adult story.
Well, yes, it is. And it's also a story, speaking of things being problematic today, an insanely problematic story because of the ridiculous age gap between the horrific age gap between Slade Wilson, a.k.a. Deathstroke, and Tara, because like you got like a she's like, I think she's even younger. I think she's like 14 or 15 or something crazy. And she's having an affair with like this, you know, full grown supervillain with like white hair who's like 50 or whatever the fuck Slade Wilson was. Like that story is just insane that was published by DC at that time. Like that was considered okay, that made it through editorial, that became I mean, I know he's the bad guy, but still, yeah, like, that's just crazy. I mean,
it's crazy, but see, but also the thing that, like, I'm going to bring up about that is that she's too young. B, you know, what's her, the wife, like, so so Deathstroke was married. He had that woman, her name's Madeline.
He was married too? Oh my God, I forgot. What a scumbag Slade Wilson was.
Well, he's not married anymore. I mean, he's divorced because, you know, his wife was a spy too. His son was Jericho, and there was another villain was his son. And there was a moment where, like, Slade Wilson or somebody had to, like, the reason why Jericho can't talk is he was used as a bargaining chip to make, like, Slade Wilson do something, and he had a knife at his throat, and Slade Wilson was like, I can still move fast enough to save my son, but the guy still got the cut across on the
man.
Like,
whoa.
It's so brutal. It's so God. Brutal.
Wow. I forgot about that.
It's so brutal. And I must have been, like, 10 or 12 when I read that, and I was saying to myself, that is some of the most brutalist shit. But again,
I think
is the only, like, DC book I was reading because it was very adult like that.
No, clearly. And Marv Wolfman was not afraid to venture into dark territory or highly transgressive or provocative territory, as we're talking about here. Two things real quick about that, Chris, because, like, yeah, you're totally shocking me with these Teen Titans memories. I don't even know what to say. Two things real quick, and I know we got to get back to Blue Devil and wrap this up. But first off, that horrific story about Jericho and how Jericho lost his voice and his ability to speak because of his dad and how horrible his dad Slade Wilson was, that, I believe, almost makes me forgive Jericho for his terrible fashion sense and that, like, horrible costume of his and, like, his super lame hairdo. Knowing about the trauma he suffered as a child almost makes me forgive his incredible transgressions when it comes to his way of dressing and doing his hair. So that's good. That gives me a bit more empathy for that character than I've ever had. So I'm glad you reminded me of this.
The thing is, I might be a little wrong. There might have been something where there was a really cool moment. I never forget this. I think it's just interesting scripting. Is that I think it was Jericho's mother, who was Slade Wilson's wife at the time. I think she was the one who was trying to save Jericho because they were coming to get them because they knew who Slade Wilson was. But she said something like, you know, there was some line in there that said, this is a weird line, but I never forget it. That he wrote, that she said, even though I had two kids, I had to slow down, you know, because she's a spy too. And she kind of able to flip and move, but she wasn't, I think she wasn't fast enough to prevent the kid or the terrorists from slicing the kids.
Good Lord. Wow. So much ego in poor Jericho's parents. They both are completely willing to risk their kids' vocal cords based on their relative super spy, supervillain skills. I mean, that's crazy. That's nuts. But the other thing really quick I wanted to say on that is just that I guess if his wife did ultimately divorce Slade Wilson, that's probably just a good lesson for everyone when picking a life partner. If someone's code name, you know, that they're known by is Deathstroke the Terminator, probably not going to be the best life partner. I'm just going to say that, you know, as a general rule. I think when your partner has a nickname like that, you know, my Angelou says,
it's not even a code name. I think his real name is, like, questionable. If your name is Slade.
Slade. You think even Slade is bad? I'm just saying, my Angelou says people show us who they are. I mean, if I meet up with someone and they tell me, like, yeah, I also go by Deathstroke, the Terminator. Yeah, I'm probably heading the other way. Okay, all right. Enough hijinks for this episode. Back to Blue Devil and this last issue. What do we got? Issue 5. We're almost done.
Yeah, page 17. That whole issue about crisis, man. I've been doing tripping it. But here's what's cool. Page 18. There's another fucking dope ass DeLuca effect.
Where yeah, you're right. It's a really nice one too. Just wow, that's amazing. Really, really great stuff, man. Paris Cullins just stays killing it throughout these issues. Paris Cullins is not messing around, man. He's really strutting his stuff on some of these panels, and that DeLuca effect here is a showstopper. Fantastic.
Yeah, it's crazy. And then and at this point he's fighting, and it's now it's the showdown for the Trident. And the Trident is mine. No, the Trident is mine. Like, who can put influence on it? You know, and at the end of it, you know, it's the Blue Devil who gets control of the Trident. And when he grabs it, he kind of like, there's this red fire around him, and he's going crazy. Mm-hmm. He's going, me, it chooses me. It's mine now, Norm.
Yeah, that's creepy as hell. Like we were talking about that panel earlier, and I thought something bad was happening to Dan in that moment. So I don't know what we're foreshadowing here.
I mean, something bad must be happening to him. I mean, you know, like I said, I remember him showing up in, this is weird because you know what? Now that I remember this, there's a panel in like issue two, issue three of Crisis where Batman is like fighting. He's with Blue Devil and he's kind of trying to talk. I mean, I had this wrong, but I remember there's a cool moment where I think Blue Devil and Batman are talking. It's the first time that Batman has met Blue Devil. He's like, hey, man. And he gets distracted because he sees the Flash in the corner of his eye because the Flash is like, now he's, you know, when he's running to turn back the Bob, the antimatter. He's like, he bounces through time a few times, you know? And he jumps right back to the beginning, which I thought. Blue Devil is somehow, is he instrumental in Crisis, like in the final three issues or something like that?
I don't remember exactly. Yeah, Crisis is all kind of a blur for me. You know, I would say we should reread it for the show sometime, but that would probably end up being like a 19-hour episode, and I don't know if you and I could survive a Crisis on Infinite Earths reread, but who knows, maybe one day. I have been curious to revisit that, and
I think I have a hardcover of it, but I haven't.
Oh, do you have like the super ultra edition that has like crazy bonus features? Because I've wanted to get that one forever. There's like a slipcase or something that came with a whole lot of behind the scenes kind of extras that are supposed to be super dope.
I think that's the one I have. I have to check.
Oh, shit. Oh, my God. If you've got that one, maybe we should do an episode on it. And then I can borrow your copy and then we could both talk about that. Because I've been really curious to read that one.
I have to check. The sad thing is that I might have sold it. I have to check.
Oh, because, no.
Because there was a time when I was having a really hard time financially. And mm-hmm. I remember the three things that I sold.
Oh.
That I never thought I would sell, and I've never got them back again. Is that there was I had a first edition. What's that Neil Gaiman thing he did with Charles Vest? That was like a Starlight or something like that. They made a movie.
Stardust.
Yeah, Stardust. So I had the hardcover. So that's $200.
Wow.
I had this hardcover Dark Knight Returns and Batman Year One that was like together, this black kind of like soft, kind of like a leather.
Oh, color. The black soft leather. Yes. You know, that's so funny you mentioned that, because I just recently learned, because I had that too, that Batman, it was like the complete Frank Miller Batman or something at the time. And it was like this soft, squishy black leather hardcover. I just recently saw a discussion of that online, and I learned for the first time ever that was a Walden Books exclusive, and explicitly or exclusively rather for Walden Books, which I had no idea of, but I had that book as well as a kid, and I don't know if I still do have it, but I believe it was so funny because it was, you know, the complete Frank Miller Batman at the time. I don't know if you remember, but do you remember there was a third Frank Miller Batman story that was also sandwiched in there along with Dark Knight and Batman Year One?
It was a weird penguin story or something like that.
It was a Frank Miller Batman story that involved Santa Claus. I believe it's called Santa Claus Wanted Dead or Alive or some shit like that. And it's completely not the equal or anywhere close of Year One or Dark Knight. So I always thought it was kind of funny that was thrown in there.
But I remember I saw that on eBay for $300 or something like
that. Wow. It was a beautiful edition. I remember the pages had like silver finish on the edge. So when you looked at it from the side, oh man, yeah, that was a really cool looking book.
I was really painting it that I might have sold the Crisis book then.
Ah, wow. Okay. All right, fair enough. Well, you know, we've all been there. Us, every comic fan has had to sell parts of their collection at some point.
So after fucking Blue Devil gets the Trident back, he's now able to focus some mystical energy, and that allows him to beat Nibirios and send Nibirios, you know, like back into his dimension.
And for now.
Yeah, for now. And it's kind of a cool panel, page 21. So the second panel, when there's like a hurricane and it's not like a silhouette, but it is a silhouette of Nibiru.
It's really weird. It's a really weird panel. I noticed that too. It's very odd and original. And yeah, it's like it's a really interesting effect there that Paris Cullins chooses as Nibirios is kind of disappearing back into his dimension. It's almost like a Zipitone type effect, but it's not. It's just looks like it's being produced just with like a whole lot of little horizontal ink lines, and it's not cross hatching. It's just like a horizontal line silhouette as if he's in like a mystical whirlwind. And it's almost like comedic, but it's also kind of iconic, like the profile of Nibiros. Yeah, it's a really, really curious sort of final look at Nibiros. Again, Paris Cullins making very novel, unique decisions visually. And I gotta say, man, he's doing some super cool stuff here.
So he's doing great stuff. So the last panel on page 21 is they've sent Nibiros back, and the cameraman Norm, he seems to have captured it all on 35mm film, which I find strange because he's never reloaded.
There you go. There's a true filmmaker critiquing the story here. I just thought Norm deserves a raise, man. Like, give this guy more money because he's really going above and beyond.
So the little denouement is like they get through thanks to the Mexican military. You know, there's a good sexual tension moment between Zatanna and Blue Devil, you know, and then on the last page, like, he's like, well, I'm about to leave. And she's like, no, I still see you as a superhero. And then she grabs his horns, you know, while she's grabbing his dick, and she like plants like a big kiss on him. And he's like, what? Like, look.
Yeah.
It's like, oh my God.
I mean, yeah, this is crazy. And it sounds almost like you're making this up, Chris. But yeah, I think the phallic significance of what Zatanna does here with Dan can really not be overstated. She grabs each of his giant protruding horns and pulls him forward while holding onto his horns, and then plants what looks like a pretty big kiss on him. And Dan is stunned. And then she just says a spell and disappears after that, and says her final words to him are, hey, call me sometime, handsome.
Yeah.
So Dan Cassaday, man, he's having quite a week. This is pretty wild.
Wild, you know. And then the whole book ends, with he's like, okay, we're still here on the island. How do we get out of here? You know,
which is pretty funny.
I don't know. They're in Mexico. They're on the coast. So
yeah, right. He's stranded.
Yeah. So that's sort of the wrap up of issue 5. That's sort of like the first, you know, the first 5 issues is sort of like a main story arc. You know, like, we got away from the Nibirios for 2 issues that came back to kind of deal with him. Yep. But, you know, but look, you know, like, this is the Blue Devil, and people need to go and read this and find these issues. I don't know if this book was ever reprinted, or
I don't know. I don't think so. I don't remember ever seeing a trade paperback or a collection for this, which is really crazy because it was an extremely popular book, I thought, at least in my world it was. And just based on kind of the general ambient chatter about the original Blue Devil run that I've seen online, I think I'm definitely not alone in having a huge amount of affection for this character and this run. And I think to a lot of people, Blue Devil was like one of the most fun comics of the 80s. And I think that you know, you can see why reading these issues. And it had, you know, the run was pretty healthy. It was like 30, 31 issues, something like that. It ended with an annual that was called the Blue Devil Summer Fun Special, which was a huge blast of a story. And it featured Kirby's Etrigan, the demon. And, you know, Blue Devil also, if I recall, one thing you learn about him later in the series is that part of his whole shtick is that as crazy things keep happening to him over and over, and like weird beings or creatures are constantly drawn to him, I believe you come to realize that part of the quote unquote curse that has been placed on Dan Cassaday, that has made him into the Blue Devil, has also made him into a bit of a quote unquote weirdness magnet. And so I believe that's the phrase that they use, because Dan is like, why does all this crazy shit keep happening to me? You know? And I think it's explained to him later, if I recall, and again, forgive me if I'm getting this slightly wrong, folks, because it's been like 25 years since I've read the rest of this, but I believe Dan was known to be a weirdness magnet. And so all of this wacky, mystical, occult stuff was constantly being magnetized to him. And honestly, that's a pretty great continuing MacGuffin slash story engine for Blue Devil. And, you know, I really miss this storyline, or I miss this character, rather. I miss this run. And like you said at the outset of this episode, Chris, DC has brought Blue Devil back in various ways into the modern continuity over the last couple decades. But really, it's been a different character. You know, the Blue Devil that has returned and been written by other writers has not been the Mishkin and Cohn and Paris Cullins, Gary Martin Blue Devil. It's been kind of like a less interesting, sort of darker character from my observation. And I think it's a shame. It's a shame because this is a super charming character with an amazing supporting cast. And yeah, I mean, if nothing else, everybody, please go check out these original issues of Blue Devil. I think, as I recall, the entire run is a blast. He gets a kid sidekick later. Kid Devil shows up, which is hilarious. And it's actually the kid who's on set in these early issues, who's like Marla's son or something. And he's like idolizing Dan. He turns into Kid Devil later. Just the whole book, man, it's so much fun, for real. And that was what they were going for at the beginning. And they really knocked it out of the park, man. The whole creative team, mission accomplished. The Trickster shows up soon. He becomes a continuing character, nemesis slash friend of Dan Cassaday, the Trickster from the Flash's Rogues Gallery. And yeah, the book is just enormously, enormously entertaining. And I can't recommend the whole series enough. And hopefully you guys got a little taste of that today.
Well, I think you made an interesting point about it comes back post the launch of Image, when and everything where things tend to skew a lot darker in the, mm-hmm. from the early 90s on. And I mean, and Spider-Man was, you know, reading this reminds me of why I used to love Spider-Man. Spider-Man, like in the late 70s and early 80s, like was a fun book. And then, yep. as soon as the dark black suit came up and Venom, it no longer really was. It was never fun. It's just lighthearted, and I feel like that's and that type of storytelling doesn't exist in comics that like I know of that much now. I mean, I'm sure it exists on some books, you know, or obviously we created our own stuff. Maybe I can't think of, you know, I mean, like that book, the new book, that Porn Side was The Man's Best. It's probably sort of lighthearted to a degree.
Oh, yeah. Man's Best from Boom, I believe.
Yeah, because it's about animals, you know? So it's like, so that in itself is going to make it like a little lighter. But it's rare, I think, to find books that are in this tone. Very rare to find. I mean, because even the Fraction and Aja Hawkeye, which is sort of light in a lot of it, is still pretty grim because the relationship that Clint Barton has with those three women, the Black Widow, and girls, and then Kate Bishop, is pretty adult, is pretty dark, is pretty, I don't say like dark, but it's very, there's a lot of drama, there's a lot of relationship drama in that, you know, and he doesn't feel, you know, there's more, it's great. He's more of a self-doubt and things like that, you know? And I don't feel like Dan Cassaday has self-doubt. I feel like he's confused and he wants his life back. But he's not like suffering from this existential dread and the angst that you feel in so many like books in the last 20 years.
Totally.
Character, you know?
No, 100%. And it's kind of like how Alan Moore has talked about often regretting what he did with Watchmen in kind of opening the floodgates between him and Frank Miller in 86 to just the grim and grittification of comics as like everybody tried to out grim and out gritty each other and tried to make these characters way too, you know, postmodern and deconstructionist and filled with angst and, you know, just trying to make these characters seem very cool and, you know, dark and, you know, just like it just frankly became exhausting, I think, to everyone, including Alan Moore. And clearly with Blue Devil, I don't think Mishkin and Cohen and Cullins were trying to seem like they were so cool by doing this story. They were just trying to have a blast. And it was incredibly earnest and like, you know, not self-conscious. And I think that's something you see in comics so much in the early to mid 80s and then post Dark Knight and post Watchmen through no fault of Alan Moore, Frank Miller, you know, Dave Gibbons or whoever, through no fault of theirs. I think it did sort of remake the whole industry into what you're talking about. And then we went from that to the Image years and kind of like, yeah, there was a certain innocence and a certain earnestness that was lost, which to me was a huge part of the wonder of these comics in the mid 80s. And that's just a damn shame. And I think we should see a lot more of that. And hopefully we will. And there are, you know, there's glimmers of it, obviously. We can't read every single book, folks. So obviously there's exceptions to what we're talking about. But we're talking about broad trends, broadly speaking, in terms of like, you know, what we've observed the last, you know, 20, 30 years.
Well, because it's like, I think about it and I think about two things I want to think about. It's like, it's the type of writing. It's like, I think you have to be a really, really skilled writer to be able to walk the balance of I can have a blast, I can be funny and jokey, but still delve into like real human drama. Because I feel like that Nexus did that really well. Like Nexus,
I knew you were gonna say that. Yeah, I knew you were gonna say that. I instantly thought of Nexus and Mike Baron too.
It explores that. But see, here's the thing too, right? It's that like I just saw the Deadpool movie with Wolverine last night. And like I like that movie, but then I don't like that movie because it's everything that we're talking about now. Like that, and in terms of this, that movie and what Ryan Reynolds tries to do is he tries to bring his brand of humor into the superhero universe and make things funny. And he has his quips, everything like that. But he is so vulgar. His comedy is absolutely so vulgar that at a certain point, to me, I checked out of the humor. I don't know, still another 30, 40 minutes left of the movie. And to me, I was like, how many more fucking like rape jokes are you going to have? How many more, you know, like anal sex jokes are you going to have? You know, and I was like, I get it. And the audience I was watching with was just howling throughout. But I say to myself, but I think that you look at a book like Nexus and you look at a book like this, where there's real human pathos, that stuff that he does, and there's a lot of comics that do this now, they don't get the pathos right after going so like horrific because they've gone so horrific. And it's just like, okay, it almost feels like I've had mentions to you before about some of the stuff. My problem with Tarantino's work is that he goes so horrible with what he's trying to show you, like this dark side of humanity, that when he wants to show you a real human emotional moment, that almost feels like it's too earnest. And it feels like it's over-earned. Uh-huh. Because you've gone so dark the other way. And I feel a balance in a book like this, in something like Nexus. You know, there was some of that we read in the Alien Legion where there was, you know, where it found this line that I think is very, very hard to walk because and it's also a tonal thing. And a lot of things, the editors, the executives and stuff, they kind of will push out a tone that veers into that lightness that is part of real life.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. That's such a great point. And I think that you have to be a writer who has a certain level of confidence in your own voice and a storyteller that's just not afraid to be perceived as like overly earnest or like, you know, emotional and all these things that I think a lot of creative people tend to be insecure about. And they want to kind of mask those feelings with like a sense of detachment vis-a-vis some irony and some ironic detachment in their storytelling, which is going to be like a postmodern shield against like, yeah, man, like don't take this shit too seriously because I don't either. And, you know, it's just kind of lame because it ultimately produces like an emotionally empty experience or kind of a hollow surface level experience, I think, for the audience. Just like you're talking about with Tarantino, where, you know, the characters ultimately, you know, they don't have recognizable human emotions. Like so much of it feels like shtick and it doesn't feel like you're having a real authentic, you know, profound human experience watching most of his films. But this is not a movie criticism podcast, so I don't want to delve too deeply into that. But I will say that I think there are comic book writers, really skilled comic writers throughout history that have managed to strike this balance really well. And I would also point to somebody like Grant Morrison. Grant Morrison, for me, at his best, does an amazing job of kind of combining the fun elements of comics, the irreverent elements of comics, without being embarrassed of them. He revels in the fun while balancing it with like genuine human emotion and, as you say, pathos. So for me, like Grant Morrison, Alan Moore, Mike Baron on so much of his Nexus stuff with Rude, I think there are some examples we can point to, just frankly, not that many that are able to balance the lightness, which, as you say, is a part of real human life. Irreverent moments, light, kind of wacky, quirky moments are part of life. Life is not an unrelenting stream of horrors. You know, there's nothing that's inherently more realistic about being all grim and gritty, you know, compared to like, oh, being like all goofy. You know, it's like life is both. And, you know, I love Blue Devil for the goofiness, and I don't even need Blue Devil to delve into the darker corners, or when it does, I'm glad that it's, you know, got a wacky joke cracking demon when the gates of hell open up. So yeah, man, I mean, I think this has been a really fun journey into the world of Blue Devil. And yeah, it, you know, like with all the books we cover, Chris, it brings up so many different thoughts for both of us about the way comics were back in the 80s and, you know, just kind of like what we miss about so much of the human charm that felt like it was the product of these very specific humans and not so much the product of a corporate assembly line manufacturing IP where we had to like keep on brand, stick on brand. Like you said, that Dick Giordano Meanwhile editorial from that Blue Devil issue that you read at the beginning of this episode, Giordano, I mean, what a champ. You know, he was like, we could keep recycling the same old IP, you know, not that he used that phrase back then, but we could keep on recycling these same books forever. But no, we're going to try new stuff because that's what we do here at DC. That's the mission. We actually have a vision. We're not just going to be coasting. I mean, literally, they had a vision at DC, you know, and props to Dick and Jeanette Kahn. I mean, it's the complete opposite of what we've seen in mainstream comics the last 20 or 25 years, which is just like, hey, what worked before? Let's double down, let's triple down, et cetera, et cetera. So yeah, man, it's all really kind of fascinating to kind of study just the different corporate mentality back then and also how it resulted in just such wildly different work, which is what we are here to celebrate.
Well, you know, the thing that I think also is that although DC is owned by Warner Brothers at the time, I don't believe that Warner Brothers is a public company at this time. You know what I'm saying? So they're not.
Interesting.
They're not. I could be wrong, but I don't feel that they became a public company until I'm not sure when that happened. But I feel like, but there's always this thing about, well, what are we gonna do with our quarterlies, and shit like that? That's gonna drive out the experimentation. I mean, the thing about a book like this, and like why a book like this is unique and rare today, and I wish something was like this today is there's like a type See, because if I go back and read this now, this does feel like a product of the time. Like the storytelling is of the time, right? Which is fine. But I'm like, okay, like what's the modern version of this? Like, you know, like if you're going to tackle something modern.
Yeah, that's a great question for us to throw out to our listeners, our viewers in the comment section. If anybody feels like we're ignoring modern comics that have a vibe or a spirit that's similar to Blue Devil, yeah, like, you know, throw that shit in the comments and let us know. I mentioned, you know, Moon Girl and Devil Dinosaur earlier. You know, there's obviously there's other fun comics out there. I just frankly don't think I'm reading a lot of them, you know? Like,
well, no, because here's the thing. To me, I'm not, because like the minute I go into the Golden Apple, first thing I see on the new release shelf is you walk in and you see the end of the alphabet. So it's a plethora of X books, you know, plethora, and then it's a bunch of Star Wars books, and you know, and it's just like stuff that I'm like, this is the biggest version of brand extension. And it's taking up like, you know, I don't know, 15-20% of their shelf space. You know,
yeah.
You have to kind of dig in the middle of their, you know, like their wall of new releases to find the books from like Image or look, I'll tell you, there was a book that was sort of fun like this. It got a little dark, but you know, there was a book called Black Cloak, right?
So, oh yeah, that was that Image book you were reading.
Yeah, I can't. It's not, was it Becky Cloonan? I don't know if you.
I don't think it was like Becky Cloonan. I want to say I think that book was just nominated for an Eisner at the Eisners this year because I feel like I saw it on the nominations list.
But that book, same. She did Cull, the Cull right now. That same author, but the art style in that book and the type of storytelling was a fantasy noir. Which I thought was really cool. And but it was a tone to that book where I was like, oh, I like this. I think I heard that book didn't get a lot of great reviews, but I almost wonder if it's because that kind of light-ish tone feels it feels like it feels out of place for the you know the audience today because they're so far.
Yeah, it's interesting you say that. It's Kelly Thompson, just to give credit where credit's due. Kelly Thompson's the writer. Meredith McLaren is the artist. And the Image website, Image publishes it, describes it, the story as, you know, Blade Runner style mixes with saga-esque drama. And, you know, Saga is probably another example, I guess one of the better examples of a book that does have a certain sense of fun to it.
Yes.
You know, and so that's probably an example. And you know, and Saga also has been wildly successful. So they've managed to get that formula and get that balance right.
Yes, there's a lot of like really heavy storytelling in like emotional storytelling in Saga. Like in the first, I stopped reading maybe some of the late 40s or early 50s of that book. But you think about it, like there's a lot of like, you know, I think there's some drug addiction.
It's quite a mix.
Yeah, there's xenophobia in that, but but the way that what's her name, the artist, like she draws it,
Fiona Staples.
She draws it in a way that it allows where things can be light, or that that she would use humor to diffuse heavy drama in real life.
Yep,
but like they do that very well.
They do a great job of that, and I think Brian K. Vaughan also brings such a great irreverent style to the writing on that. Frequently very irreverent combined with these moments of like real human drama and life and death situations. So yeah, I mean, I think Saga is kind of an effervescent cocktail of a space opera intergalactic war book, you know? So yeah, that's probably as good an example as any for us to kind of end on an optimistic note for relatively modern comics from the last decade. But yeah, man, I mean, that's it. I think, that's Blue Devil, folks. Just check out the book. Hopefully you've enjoyed the art, and, thank you everyone for tuning in. Chris, did you have any final thoughts on Blue Devil that you still wanted to share?
No.
Okay.
Said what I wanted to say.
Okay, that's excellent. All right, well then I will just say let's wrap up the episode by thanking everybody for watching and listening to the show. If you've actually made it this far to the very end of the episode, then congratulations. You are one of the hardcore listeners, hardcore viewers, and we appreciate that so much. And we'd appreciate it even more if you could please make sure that you subscribe on YouTube and also be sure to hit the like button and drop a comment if you are so inclined. Please tell us about the fun comics we're missing for today, or just tell us anything, any of your random thoughts on Blue Devil. We'd love to hear from you. And, you know, I was thinking recently, Chris, we need like a good closing line for these episodes. We don't have that yet. We need like a good final line to kind of send people off into the night with. So, you know, I don't know what that is yet, but we should work on something. I think it would be a, very professional thing for us to do.
Yeah, the thing we need is that this, and you know, we need is my line I tell everyone from fucking the apartment. Final one is shut up and deal. This is what we want.
Oh shit! Okay, I don't know if that's the most positive message.
Well, it's not.
No, to send everybody off with, but you know, it'll do for today.
What I was saying, it's such a great line that references something else in the movie that it's like, oh, I love. It's, I mean, like basically, Shirley Clayton is telling Jack Lemmon, "I love you," by saying, and it's like,
shut up and deal.
Yeah, it's like.
That's cool. All right. Well, we need our version of that.
Yeah,
that's really funny. Okay. Well, thank you, folks. We'll be back again in a week or so with some other comic from the '80s, and we'll talk to you then. Thanks for listening.